all about one man, but him attack Iraq. And thousands of people died because of this. So them continue the war in Afghanistan. And thousands of people died and still dying, both in Afghanistan and Pakistan. Say them looking for this one man. Up to today. Well, yesterday, like a 12-year-old, you tie on a bomb on him and blow up some people in Pakistan. But up to today, the NATO forces kill some people that do have nothing to do with Bin Laden. And right now, many people is dying that do have nothing to do with Bin Laden. Now, Bin Laden, they tell us, is dead. Them dump him in the sea. Now the question is, will this war in Afghanistan stop because they have now caught the man that they are looking for? Because America not supposed to be in the job of changing governments, even though they do it many, 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 many times. The problem with it is that Obama, a black man sitting in the White House, is now at the center of this thing here now that take place. That when he became president, he did say that he's going to capture and kill Bin Laden. Well, we see that word come to pass. But there are so many questions that is not answered. And we will hear about these things later down when things start to more come up to bump. And it going come up to bump. It going come up to bump. Because when we heard his first statements, not even 24 hours after, most of what he said, except the part that Bin Laden is dead, most of what he said never go so. Why was it that this man who could stop this so-called terrorism that is taking place? We know that over the years, well, couple years ago, maybe even more than couple years ago, Wally Poway did kind of get nervous to fly up and plane, especially American plane there where we go certain place. Man, fret. Meanwhile, artists will say, nah, go America again because he's afraid of play the bomb up with him and all them something there. All right. So it cooled down. We don't hear nothing more. Them couldn't find Bin Laden. Some people all write books, same dead. Yeah, man. You have books where 3-4 years ago we say Bin Laden dead. You have books where sure you say the picture them will come out with these messages where Bin Laden get is not Bin Laden. Because they must show you. Oh, the ring upon him, this finger and this a finger and that the finger. All right. So, Bin Laden is supposed to be dead a couple of years ago from some problem where he did have, bladder problem or some problem where he did have. And he was supposed to be in at his cave, a hideout. Well, now it come to, things come up to bump that Bin Laden never did a hide. Bin Laden was living right beside the military houses of the Pakistani army, like walking distance from which part the Pakistani army there, Bin Laden was living there, according to the news portal. Okay. If you kept alive, maybe him could be interrogated and you find out now how to dismantle Al Qaeda. Or maybe you would hear some things that would make you cringe if you know, say, a whole heap of things that is said is not so it go. But this is how it go now, because you hear it now from the ass's mouth. So, the order was given to the CIA director, Leon Panetta, that they should not bring in Bin Laden alive. The order was given that they should not bring Bin Laden alive. He should be killed. And hear the whole heap of this and that. But I don't know how much people know, say, Bin Laden never have no gun. When them find him, he was there with him family, and he was a sickly man. He was there with him wife and some of him children them. And guess what? Them tell we say, the wife dead, this, that dead, and all dead. But guess what? The Pakistani is now holding one of his wives and his 12-year-old daughter who saw what happened and told the Pakistani police and military what happened. That they saw, and this is not only the daughter who is saying this, but it has now been confirmed by even the Americans that they took Bin Laden out of the house alive and kill him. And we watch the Americans in front of the White House like old Romans in the Colosseums of Rome, watching the lion eat the Christians and cheer. And they cheer. Now, somebody can tell me, what is the difference between Bin Laden, who on that side of the world is seen as a hero standing up against this mighty America, and America that is now saying that they have captured a man who come like Hitler, but yet still them couldn't bring him in alive? And that is the question now. Even the congressmen are asked, if them did capture him without any gun, why did they have to kill him? When it would serve international dismantling of terrorism and Al-Qaeda more if he was captured and questioned and carried to a court. It would serve international terrorism. It would serve, be better to do that. Know this and the inner workings and all these things. And maybe I am reminded, and I can't forget a lot of politicians in Jamaica, where the police them get some youth out of some community, and when the youth them left the community, they were alive. And then little more in the newspaper, you hear say the youth pull a gun and was shot by the police. Or when him reached to the university, he was pronounced dead on arrival. Now, I don't know, because I listen to Obama. Believe you me, people. I sit down and I watch Obama say this thing, and I never believe nothing where I say, including. And this is so weird, because I do believe. Yes. Eh? Yeah. I do believe that they kill Obama. I mean, Osama. I do believe that they kill him. I don't feel, say, in my life somewhere. I do believe. Yet, still, you're going to hear the same down dead, Twitter. Yeah, you're going to hear the same down dead. But I do believe that they kill him. But guess what? what is it in me that is watching this black man saying this thing? And I am saying that no go so. Why should I, an intelligent person, sit and watch the president of the United States, and not only the president of the United States, but a black man making some pronouncements about this event? And I am sitting there and saying, that brother, you are telling a lie, you know, Rasta. Am I getting psychologically imbalanced or something that I could really sit there and hear this thing happening and saying that nothing goes so? Only for here the next morning that a whole heap of the things we have said nothing goes so. Only to hear that the next day, when I start to search and search and search, we come here say nothing goes so. Him never did a put up no fight. Nobody never hold no woman in front of them and shank the woman get shot. And him 12-year-old daughter saw the whole incident, that now them have them in a cell in Pakistan. Them have the family. Meanwhile, Obama now have to retract a whole heap of the things that he was saying. What kind of world we're living in? Why do we continuously believe these people? The whole of the Western world is set on lies, thievery, genocide, homicide. I mean, all the decadence that you can ever think, the whole of the Western world is built on that. Them politics tainted, them religion tainted, them cultural expression tainted. Why should we believe these people, or continue to believe these people, or anybody that is used by them as their mouthpiece to perpetuate their supremacy on the entire world and call it globalization? If the director of the CIA come out and say he was authorized to kill, to assassinate Bin Laden, he was authorized to assassinate Bin Laden, and Bin Laden was unarmed in the house, and it was no big posh place neither. It was not, I always hear them attack, but not go so. Can you have to listen to the other news them, you know? You can't just watch where the American them are saying, you know? Because the American them tell you one thing in the mouthpiece of the president, and the next thing them have to go retract what them say. It's a serious thing, you know? You have alternative news other than CNN and Fox Channel in America. So we're going to play alternative news. And this is a debate. This is a debate about this thing here that take place. Because you're going to hear about this thing here long time. And you're going to hear all different kind of things. And me never in the house. You never in the house. But people did in there know what happened. Soldiers, American soldiers go in there and them know what happened. The family, a lot of them that was in there, never dead, and them know what happened. So when we hear Obama come out and talk and then have to retract what him say, how much more retraction is necessary? Can we hear him say him want to give high praises to the president of Pakistan? And then we see the Congress, I say, they must hold back aid from Pakistan, because the Pakistani, them, they know, say Bin Laden, did they write this all for how long? And them say, them all say 5 years. Yet still know where you say 4 months him to live there. What a call. And now the threat of terrorism has been heightened. because of this incident now. So now we are back to square one now. We're going to have to think now about flying again, about people with shoes. And then we're going to find some other little way to do this thing. And then we're going to go to the airport and man have to go do this and that and long line for make you miss flight and all them something there. Is a weird, weird, weird thing. This is the Cutting Edge on RFM.
I can report to the American people and to the world. The United States has conducted an operation that killed Osama bin Laden, the leader of Al-Qaeda, and a terrorist who's responsible for the murder of thousands of innocent men, women, and children.
President Obama announces Osama bin Laden is dead. Could this mean the U.S. will end its war in Afghanistan? We'll host a roundtable discussion. We'll speak with Robert Fisk. He interviewed Osama bin Laden several times. We'll also be joined by journalist Jeremy Scahill. He's been closely tracking the very group of special ops soldiers that reportedly killed bin Laden. We'll also speak with journalist Alan Ayer, and we'll go to London to talk to Tariq Ali and to Washington, D.C. to speak with Joshua Faust, former analyst at the Defense Intelligence Agency. And we'll go to Long Island to speak with Talat Hamdani, the mother of Mohammed Salman Hamdani. He died in the 9/11 attacks on the World Trade Center. He was 23 years old. She's a member of the group September 11 Families for Peaceful Tomorrows. All that and more coming up. Welcome to Democracy Now!, democracynow.org, The War and Peace Report. I'm Amy Goodman. The manhunt for Osama bin Laden is over. Nearly 10 years after the attack on the World Trade Center and Pentagon, U.S. forces are said to have assassinated the Saudi-born founder of Al-Qaeda on Sunday inside Pakistan. President Obama addressed the news late on Sunday night.
Today, at my direction, the United States launched a targeted operation against that compound in Abbottabad, Pakistan. A small team of Americans carried out the operation with extraordinary courage and capability. No Americans were harmed. They took care to avoid civilian casualties. After a firefight, they killed Osama bin Laden and took custody of his body.
One of bin Laden's sons, two other men, and one woman were also killed in the attack. U.S. officials said bin Laden was buried at sea after a DNA test was conducted. At the time of his death, bin Laden was living in a heavily fortified mansion just a mile from the Pakistani Army's principal military academy. The U.S. operation was reportedly carried out by 25 Navy SEALs under the command of the Joint Special Operations Command. It's unclear what role Pakistan played in the killing. The Pakistan Taliban has threatened to attack Pakistani leaders, army, and the United States after the bin Laden killing. Meanwhile, the U.S. Army has increased security levels at all of its bases and installations. Crowds began gathering outside the White House and at Ground Zero late last night, celebrating the news of bin Laden's death. This is Jake DiLiberto, a Marine Corps veteran who fought in Afghanistan and Iraq.
We've been chasing this ghost bin Laden around Afghanistan and Iraq and Pakistan and Yemen and everywhere else. And finally, we can bring back, bring our troops home. We can use the rule of law to protect our borders against another terrorist attack or something like this. But we don't need to be sending our troops and invading other countries anymore. And today's a good day for us.
Osama bin Laden was shot in the head and buried at sea. We'll have more on his death after headlines. The killing of Osama bin Laden comes as Taliban-led militants announced a springtime offensive in Afghanistan, killing at least 11 people on Sunday. In one attack, a suicide bomber said to be 12 years old killed four people. The Taliban has warned civilians to stay away from public gatherings, military bases, and convoys, as well as government offices. In news from Libya, NATO forces bomb Muammar Gaddafi's compound Saturday, killing his 29-year-old son Saif al-Arab and three of his grandchildren, all of whom were under the age of 12. Gaddafi was reportedly inside the compound at the time of the attack. Democratic Congress member Denis Kucinich condemned the NATO attack, saying, quote, NATO's leaders have blood on their hands. NATO's airstrike seems to have been intended to carry out an illegal policy of assassination. Another NATO airstrike damaged a Libyan preschool for children with Down syndrome and two government buildings. Hours after the attack, backers of the Libyan government set fire to the vacant British and Italian embassies in Tripoli, as well as the U.S. Commercial and Consular Affairs Department. Following the fires, the United Nations evacuated its international staff from Tripoli. Meanwhile, the Libyan city of Misrata remains under siege. There are reports Gaddafi has ordered Libyan naval vessels to mine Misrata harbor and has threatened to attack any ships that brought food or medicine to the residents of the besieged city. In a televised address to the nation last night, President Barack Obama announced al-Qaeda leader Osama bin Laden had been killed by U.S. forces in Pakistan. Bin Laden was killed on Sunday in a U.S. operation in the Pakistani city of Abbottabad, about 60 miles north of the capital, Islamabad.
Tonight, I can report to the American people and to the world that the United States has conducted an operation that killed Osama bin Laden, the leader of al-Qaeda, and a terrorist who's responsible for the murder of thousands of innocent men, women, and children.
Osama bin Laden was shot in the head and buried at sea. The Saudi-born leader of al-Qaeda is believed to be the mastermind of the attacks on New York and Washington on September 11, 2001, as well as a number of other attacks around the world. Osama bin Laden's death raises questions about the future of the U.S. war on terror and whether U.S. policy in the region will change. Almost 10 years ago, on October 7, 2001, the U.S. invaded Afghanistan. In an attempt to capture bin Laden and destroy his al-Qaeda network, the war in Afghanistan has since become the longest in U.S. history and has resulted in tens of thousands of deaths. For years, the U.S. has also waged a secret war inside Pakistan. Despite the killing of Osama bin Laden, Australian Prime Minister Julia Gillard said today the war on terror will continue.
Can I say too about the death of Osama bin Laden that whilst al-Qaeda has been hurt today, al-Qaeda is not finished. Our war against terrorism must continue. We continue to be engaged in Afghanistan so that that country does not again become a haven for terrorists. That work will need to continue. That work has already cost Australian lives, but that work is vital, and we will continue the mission in Afghanistan.
To discuss the death of Osama bin Laden, we're joined by a number of guests. We'll be speaking with Robert Fisk on the phone in Beirut. Robert Fisk, the longtime Middle East correspondent of the Independent newspaper in London, he was the first Western journalist to interview Osama bin Laden. We're also joined in New York by Jeremy Scahill, Puffin Foundation writing fellow at the Nation Institute, author of Blackwater, The Rise of the World's Most Powerful Mercenary Army. He blogs at thenation.com. We're also joined by Alan Nairn, an award-winning investigative journalist and activist. In London, we're joined by Tariq Ali, the well-known author, Pakistani-born commentator. We're going to start with Jeremy Scahill. Jeremy, tell us what you understand. You have been following Jason.
Pakistan was the culmination of the life's work of General Stanley McChrystal, who headed the Joint Special Operations Command from 2003 to 2008, and was the man tasked by the Bush administration with leading a global assassination campaign of people that the administration determined to be high-value targets or terrorist threats or militant threats to the United States. The current commander of JSOC is Admiral William McRaven, who himself is a former Navy SEAL. And this really is the most elite force within the U.S. military. The individuals who we believe actually killed Osama bin Laden are reportedly members of Navy SEAL Team 6, also known as the Development Group. And those are probably the most elite forces in the world. General Barry McCaffrey said these are the most dangerous people on planet Earth. This operation was carried out by a drone that was overhead, 25 SEALs, and then shooters that allegedly stormed this compound. The role of JSOC within the broader U.S. So-called war on terror has been a surgical strike force. So I think you have the one story playing out, which is how this happened. And it does sound like there was some incredible detective work that took place in tracking this courier who was Osama bin Laden's go-to to communicate with the outside world. For 5 years, they were reportedly tracking the developments at this compound. Interesting, this compound is a stone's throw away from a Pakistani military academy. And just days ago, General Kayani, the head of Pakistan's armed forces, actually was basically a block away from Osama bin Laden, if all of these reports are true. On the other side of this, though, I think there's another reaction. I found it quite disgusting to see people chanting like it was some sort of sporting event outside of the White House. I think it was idiotic. Let's remember here, hundreds of thousands of people have died. Iraq was invaded, a country that had nothing to do with al-Qaeda, nothing to do with Osama bin Laden. The United States created an al-Qaeda presence in Iraq by invading it, made Iran a far more influential force in Iraq than it ever would have been. We have given a grand motivation to people around the world that want to do harm to Americans in our killing of civilians, our waging of war against countries that have no connection to al-Qaeda, and by staying in these countries long after the mission was accomplished. Al-Qaeda was destroyed in Afghanistan, forced on the run. The Taliban have no chance of retaking power in Afghanistan. And so I think that this is a somber day where we should be remembering all of the victims, the 3,000 people that died in the United States, and then the hundreds of thousands that died afterwards as a result of a U.S. response to this that should have been a law enforcement response and instead was to declare war on the world.
Can you talk, Jeremy, about what you understand did take place in this, not place in the frontier and the right. border, the tribal lands between Pakistan and Afghanistan, but in a mansion in a city of 500,000 next to a military academy?
This is a very big problem for Pakistan's government. Because had Osama bin Laden been captured in an area that the Pakistani government didn't have control of, there would have been a very different narrative that would have unfolded. You already see right-wing commentators, former Bush officials, really ratcheting up their rhetoric about Pakistan and the fact that he was captured in what was essentially a town equivalent to Vail, Colorado, a vacation town, really shows that he must have had some sort of protection from the Pakistani state in order to live for so long, at least 5 years, it seems, in this location, rather than being in a cave somewhere. The way that this operation went down, if in fact it is confirmed that it was the Joint Special Operations Command coming in from Afghanistan, goes back to an agreement that General McChrystal brokered with then-President Pervez Musharraf of Pakistan that allowed what was called the Hot Pursuit Clause, which authorized U.S. Special Operations Forces to go into Pakistan from Afghanistan if they were in pursuit of Osama bin Laden or other al-Qaeda leaders. And the agreement was that the U.S. could do those operations as long as the Pakistani government could then deny it. And so it seems as though this operation was at least in part launched from Afghanistan into Pakistan, President Obama chairing 5 National Security Council meetings about this specific operation. So I think that, there's going to be a lot of celebrating within the special ops community for having taken down the man that was identified as the number one target of this operation. And it shows that President Obama has really continued and doubled down on the Bush administration policy of target assassination. Assassination leading the way in terms of America's response to al-Qaeda and to people it designates as so-called terrorists.
And the news of how Osama bin Laden died?
Well, that's interesting. Alan and I were talking before the show about this, and I'd be interested in hearing what he has to say. The phrasing that President Obama used was very interesting. I mean, we'll have to see before I think we give any detailed commentary on it. They said there was a firefight there. They said someone used a woman as a human shield at some point during the operation. It sounds like Osama bin Laden was shot in the head. Navy SEALs are the most highly trained forces within the U.S. military. It wouldn't be surprising that they could sniper shoot him from a distance and hit him dead between his eyes. Maybe something else went down. We don't know what happened inside of that compound, but it does sound like he was shot directly in the head.
And buried at sea.
And then they say buried at sea. I'm not sure exactly what that means. If they took him down deep into the sea and buried him, or if they just dumped his body. I mean, we don't know.
We're going to go to break and come back, and we'll be joined by Talat Hamdani. Talat Hamdani lost her son, 9/11. She is the mother of Mohammed Salman Hamdani. This is Democracy Now!, democracynow.org, the War and Peace Report. We'll also be joined by Matthew Ho, highest level diplomat to have quit amidst the war in Afghanistan.
This is Ian LaVanzant, author of Acts of Faith, and you are listening to Muta Baruka.
Yeah. What are you good for?
Absolutely
nothing.
Star. This is Democracy Now!, democracynow.org, the War and Peace Report. I'm Amy Goodman. The news of this day, of this weekend, the news right now coming out of not only Washington, D.C., but around the world, Osama bin Laden is dead. Talat Hamdani is our guest right now, mother of Mohammed Salman Hamdani. Mohammed Salman Hamdani died in the 9/11 attacks at the World Trade Center. He was 23 years old. She's a member of the group September 11th Families for Peaceful Tomorrow. She's joining us by phone from Long Island. Her son, a police cadet who raced to World Trade Center to try to save people. He was working at Rockefeller University. And before they knew it, while their son had died a hero, the New York Post and others were suggesting that he was a terrorist, that he was responsible for what had taken place. Well, all that changed when his remains were found, and the police commissioner, the mayor, and others attended his funeral. And Mohammed Salman Hamdani is named in the USA Patriot Act. Talat Hamdani, your response to the news that Osama bin Laden is dead?
It is a relief that finally, after 10 long years, justice has been done to all those people that died on 9/11. And also the hope is that we will move forward as a united country, as well as globally united, towards the path of peace and justice instead of the past 10 years that we have been on revenge and killing. We also have to keep in mind, as a country, we need to lead by example, and our rule of law and our civil liberties and our constitution has, since 9/11 has happened, has been very strained, and hopefully we will go back to our original values, and not only in domestic policies, but for policies abroad also.
Talat Hamdani, your family, your other sons, their thoughts today? Your husband has since died.
Yes, my one son, he does not get involved. He doesn't express himself, so to say. My younger one, he said he's happy, because this man not only killed his mother, but killed his father also. And he did give a statement yesterday. So, yes, he's happy. There is a sense of, people are expressing as they went down to Ground Zero and at the Times Square. There's a closure. It was something that the whole world was waiting for. More importantly, people who died that day and their families were waiting for. So, a big sense, that's a big relief. And one message I would really, like to give, that no matter who our enemy is, and no matter what part of the world they are in, there is no refuge for them. No, we will find them out. America will find them out and bring them to justice.
Talat Hamdani, I want to thank you for being with us, joining us from Long Island, New York. Lost her son, Salman Hamdani, in the 9/11 attacks. We're going right now to Islamabad, to the journalist Musharraf Zaidi, who was tweeting yesterday, early before all this news came out, asking questions like, why was a U.S. helicopter down? We're hoping that we have him on the line. Mohammed Zaidi. It looks like we just lost him. We'll try to get him in a minute. Tariq Ali is with us in Britain. Tariq, your response to what has taken place?
Amy, what is quite astonishing is that it took them such a long time. The news is that he was in a safe house, which is literally next door to the Kakul Military Academy, one of the most heavily protected areas in the country. And the notion that this was a secret from Pakistan's military intelligence is risible. It's just not believable. I think the fact that he was there, the fact that they knew he was there. So the question that is intriguing me is how this information, I don't believe that. I think that the information came from within Pakistan's military intelligence. And what was the pressure put to get it from them? I think the Pakistanis were informed that this was going to happen. The Pakistan's leadership was already with pat answers celebrating the event. The Prime Minister, Zardari, Karzai in Kabul. So I think they had been planning it. The timing is a mystery. Why they did it exactly at this moment, given that they've known that he was there. So that's my first reaction. The second reaction is, of course, as Jeremy has also said, that it's far better when these things are done legally. Because to show that state terrorism is more powerful than individual terrorism is bizarre. I mean, everyone knows that. The United States is more powerful than virtually the rest of the world put together, so we don't need a demonstration of that. What we needed, which Obama didn't talk about, was why wasn't he captured alive? They could have done that if they knew where he was. The Pakistanis could have been told to do that and tried in a court of law. That would have been genuinely educative and revelatory to try him, to prove him guilty, and then to imprison him, Tariq, or whatever. They didn't go down that route.
Tariq, we've just gotten Musharraf Zaidi on, and I want to make sure we get him in from Islamabad. Musharraf, you were early on tweeting that a U.S. helicopter had gone down yesterday. This is before we knew anything about Osama bin Laden being dead. What is the latest you understand, especially of Pakistani involvement in the killing of Osama bin Laden? And what is the reaction today in Islamabad?
Oh, thanks, Amy. I'm actually driving from Abbottabad to Islamabad right now, after having spent the better part of the day there. The helicopter fell on during the operation on the compound of a little plot of land on which bin Laden was living. There was there's been an implicit denial by the Pakistani government in its official statement.
Continent!
Pakistan being intricately involved in this. But the notion of there not having been any involvement by Pakistan in this, it rings nonsensical and a little bit far-fetched. The city Abbottabad is a garrison town. It was founded by a British major in 1853. It's kind of a hill station. A lot of people enjoy the weather there during the summers, and so people have sort of a dual residence. Abbottabad itself is the largest urban area between the Punjab province, which is the largest province in Pakistan, and the Pakhtunkhwa province, which is the province, it's the Pakhtun province, it's the province in which so much of the activity that's been happening in Pakistan is sourced. The specific neighborhood is a reasonably sort of middle class, upper middle class neighborhood. the house is said to have been electronically fenced and well guarded. The idea that bin Laden got from Tora Bora to that house over the last 7 or 8 years without a single element of the Pakistani state knowing about it, it just doesn't ring true. What rings even more hollow is the notion that somehow U.S. military choppers, gunships could fly into Pakistan undetected by jammer radars and hover above the house, have one of the choppers crash, have another chopper end up there, kill bin Laden, take a few of the people there, capture them and fire them away. And all of this could happen without any coordination, any kind of approval, any kind of data or information sharing with the Pakistani security establishment, the Pakistani state. It just sounds like really a flight of somebody's fancy. Mm.
And the plane that went down yesterday, the helicopter, the U.S. helicopter, though they said no one died in that crash?
That's right. We heard that there were no casualties. Nobody, as far as I know, nobody's actually seen the wreckage so far. People did hear a massive blast, and the reports locally and internationally were that the helicopter had fallen there. Originally, we were told that that helicopter was a Pakistani helicopter. Today, it's the line has been that there were both U.S. helicopters. Sources in Pakistan that are reasonably trustworthy confirmed that they're U.S. helicopters. Some people say two, others say four. The compound itself, the location where this happened, and the fact that, a helicopter went down, allegedly a helicopter went down, suggests that, this was a significant operation that would have been possible without the support of parts of the Pakistani state.
Jeremy Scahill.
Also, on the issue of the helicopter, I mean, we understand that it was what's called the Little Bird helicopter, which is a very lightweight helicopter that Blackwater types and JSOC types have often used in Iraq and to an extent in Afghanistan. The reports are that it was then destroyed by the U.S. forces after it went down, and the official line is that it was a mechanical failure. There are other reports that say that it was brought down by some kind of arms fire from within the compound. I mean, we probably won't know that. I would concur with what Musharraf is saying. I mean, the idea that U.S. special ops forces are operating in Pakistan without the knowledge of the Pakistani government is, in fact, ludicrous. And that's why when this deal was originally brokered by Musharraf and McChrystal, the public posture had to be that the Pakistanis would deny it. Let's remember, too, that this killing of Osama bin Laden takes place just months after Raymond Davis, who was a man who straddled the world of both the CIA and special operations forces, killed two men in Lahore, Pakistan. And then after weeks of controversy, was eventually taken out of the country after payments were made to the families of his victims. One of the things that Raymond Davis is suspected of having done inside of Pakistan was having communications with people in the tribal areas, but also potentially targeting Lashkar-e-Taiba, which is a terrorist organization behind the Mumbai bombings that has been designated by the U.S. as a state sponsor of terrorism, and that the U.S. accuses of having very close ties to the ISI. So the timing of this operation coming as soon as it did after this epic scandal with Raymond Davis, perhaps the most serious crisis between Pakistan and U.S. governments in a decade, or maybe even since the ransacking of the U.S. embassy in Islamabad in 1979, is curious to say the least. But I think there's two questions here. Were the Pakistanis giving sanctuary to Osama bin Laden in this town that Musharraf has just described, a heavily populated town with big military presence? And what was the full role of the Pakistani government in ultimately killing Osama bin Laden?
This Mother's Day weekend, take mom to see David McIntosh's hilarious Double Dose with Shabada.
You are History Channel, them girls at Nickelodeon and Disney.
Bad Boy Trevor, Babalita, and the stage is crew. Saturday, May 7th, Hotel Versailles, May 10th, 8:30 p.m. And Mother's Day, May 8th, Transport Center Odria, 7:30 p.m. Wine and roses for the first 100 mothers. Get your tickets early.
Special guest, Dalton Harris.
Me not yam fish. Me allergic to fish.
A divided Jamaica will not succeed. We need more unity and positive attitudes, less negativity and injustice, so growth and productivity can multiply. Under Jamaican law, nobody is greater than or less than anybody else. We are all equal. We are one. We are Jamaica.
A message from the Ministry of National Security.
Here's your last chance to get that perfect Mother's Day gift for mommy at Azanzi in the Springs and Sovereign Center's Super Sale, which ends this Saturday.
Guinness, reach for greatness.
Cut it out!
Swag, 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 swag.
Tell it, tell it, tell it, tell it.
Swagging, we swag.
What is Guinness in the street? Mobile Zone Edition. From March to the end of June. Coming to a bar near you. Tell them. Hey, man and woman, give yourself a chance. Want to see everybody do the swag dance. Swag contest, come get your hand pass. Guinness ready place and Guinness at the team.
Must be 18 or older, enjoy Guinness responsibly.
For all your eye care, visit American Eyewear, 30 Union Street, Montego Bay. We offer free eye exam, blood pressure check, and eyeglass frames. Glasses in one day. 971-6495.
Air Jamaica.
Everything you love and even more too.
Air Jamaica, soaring to new heights. Everything you love, everything you love and more.
Every day a new beginning.
Yes, that is what I'm talking about. With Western Union, I can send money nationwide and around the world. For birthday, back to school, emergencies, anything. My people in East can feel me, even if I'm in the West.
Yeah, man, I knew that. Western Union work from parish to parish and town to town. And you can send and receive worldwide too.
Now that is progress.
Yes!
Western Union money transfer. Yes.
Rustlick and CK presents Unconditional Love Sunday, May the 8th, Little Bay Beach, Little London, Jocure and Idonia. Admission 800 pre-sold, 1000 at the gate and 1200 day and night. Music by Extra Hype and DJ Blade, Mucky and Gemini, MC a Sampleman. Sponsors Liquid Nitro and IRFN. Members at Day and Night Event.
On the 8th of May in a
Little Bay Beach,
Little London. Make sure me see before them.
Unconditional Love.
This is an IRFM Big Up.
Take mom this Mother's Day weekend to see Del Cita, Romaine Virgo, and Stage's crew.
Mesita, me never tell about your father to make life easier for you.
Over my dead body. Saturday, May 7th, Colonel Cove, St. Thomas, 8:30 p.m. And Mother's Day, Sunday, May 8th, Wyndham Hotel, New Kingston, two shows, 5 and 8:30 p.m. Get your tickets at Lloyd's Pharmacy, Wyndham Hotel, and Green Gables Theater.
Total Premier 8790 and diesel. Whether you ride a motorbike, drive a truck, car, or bus, Total Premier is a high-quality range of fuels with new additives that clean and protect all engines, giving you more kilometers per tank full, longer engine life, and less engine maintenance. Get more with new Total Premier 8790 and diesel today. Total. You know where to turn.
All I meant, you know, here, continent, the end, the end.
Man, how could this, you know, this sort of quite grand operation and ostensibly successful operation have taken place? People feel a little bit starstruck by the fact that the eyes and ears of the world are now very intently focused on the city of Ahmedabad. Mm.
I wanted to bring Alan Nairn into this conversation. Your response to the news and what you think this could mean. Could this mean the end of the U.S. war with Afghanistan?
I don't think it will. It should. It definitely should be an occasion for rethinking everything on a much bigger scale than Afghanistan. The first thing that struck me was seeing the Americans out in the streets celebrating outside the White House, outside the old World Trade Center site, people cheering people exultant. And while some of that may come from bloodlust, I think a lot of it comes from a sense of justice. People like justice. They want to see it. And in this case, I think many people have the feeling, well, he got what he deserved. This was a man who had massacred civilians. He got what he deserved. And there's a lot of truth to that. But if we recognize that someone who is willing to kill civilians en masse, someone who is willing to send young people out with weapons and bombs to, as President Obama put it, see to it that a family doesn't have a loved one sitting at the dinner table anymore, see to it that a child and a parent never meet again. If we say that someone like that deserves to die, then we have to follow through on that idea. And we have to recognize, okay, if these things really are so enormous, we have to stop them. Killing bin Laden does not stop them. Bin Laden is dead, but the world is still governed by bin Ladens. People cheer because they thought they saw justice, but this was not justice delivered by, a kind of rough justice delivered by victims. This was one killer killing another. A big killer, the United States government, killing another, someone who's actually a smaller one, bin Laden. And the bin Laden doctrine that to take out the CIA office that was at the World Trade Center, it's okay to blow up the whole World Trade Center. To teach Americans a lesson, it's okay to slaughter thousands of Americans. That doctrine lives on in the American White House, in the American Pentagon. You know, every day, and in seats of authority all over the world, every day the U.S., directly with its own forces, or indirectly through its proxy forces, its clients, is killing at a minimum dozens of people. I mean, just since Obama came in the one limited area of drone strikes in Pakistan, something like 1,900 have been killed just under Obama. And that started decades before 9/11. We have to stop these people. These powerful people like Obama, like Bush, like those who run the Pentagon, and who think it's okay to take civilian life. And it doesn't seem that they can be stopped by normal routine politics. Because under the American system, as in most other systems, people don't even know this is happening. People know the face of bin Laden. They know the evil deeds that he's done. They see that he's dead, and they say, oh, great, we killed bin Laden. But they don't see the other 20, 30, 50, 100 people who the U.S. killed that day, many of them children, many of them civilians. If they did, they probably wouldn't be out in the street cheering about those deaths. You know, we've got to stop this practice. And Americans aren't doing it. Egyptians, Tunisians are doing their part. They've risen up against the repression they face. I think we need an American uprising if we're to put a stop to this kind of killing of innocent people. And we need an American Romero. Someone like Archbishop Romero of Salvador.
Yeah, this is the Cutting Edge on IRFM, where I was just tuning into a debate about this recent thing that is happening in the world now that seemed to go and to take the interests of all of us. And this man who just finished said a proper thing to end this debate here, that killers killing killers. I'm talking about killers killing killers. And even though we know about the killings of Bin Laden because of his publicity, yet still, this man, this American is telling you that America is killing children daily and people daily. So he's saying that killers killing killers, when we're going to stop it. So, as we said, this is going to continue again and again and again because there's so much other things left to be revealed that we still don't know. And them kill Bin Laden because if he was to talk, we know what would happen if them did allow him to live. Yes, we know what would happen. But this is the Cutting Edge on IRFM, you know, say, we come with things and different things and different things. Tonight, we have a special, special guest inside of the studio here. We never announce him because it come up and we couldn't afford for make this man leave Jamaica and don't present him to the Jamaican people. And also, it's a pity we never shoot the television series yet, because it would be really nice to have him on the television too. But then again, it's so it go. But the rest of the night, we're going to spend with, you know, say, we don't want to call him name wrong. We don't want to call him name wrong, because we don't feel when somebody call my name wrong. It's Ibon. Eh?
Hello.
Ebo On.
Yeah.
From Nigeria.
Yes.
All right. We have Ebo On. I don't even want to call the first day. I'm afraid to call the first day, you know, because I don't want to. Osemwege.
You are correct.
Osemwege.
Yeah.
All right. See there? But no, it's a bit African for a long time. Osemwege Ebo On.
Yes.
All right. Ibo.
As long as you call me a human being's name, I will answer.
Okay. No, I won't. I'm just. No, no, I'm saying yes. Ibo. No.
Not at all.
Yoruba.
Call me Aida Egi.
Egi.
That's.
Yeah. Yes.
Yes.
Well, you said I'll call you either Egi. Okay, so I can call you Egi then.
Egi. Although it will be an abomination if you call me that in Benin or Nigeria.
Well, I don't want to call you something with abomination in Nigeria.
Okay, call me Chief.
Chief, yes. Ebohorn.
Chief Ebohorn.
Chief Ebohorn. Yes. All right, you are a chief in which state?
Osami Egi Ebohorn.
You're a chief in which state?
Chief Ebohorn.
In which state? In Nigeria.
Edo State, Benin Kingdom.
All right.
It's the oldest kingdom on earth.
All right. You know, I spent a month in Bendel State.
Yeah, I was told.
Yeah, I spent a month there in 1982.
Yeah.
My first trip to Africa was to Nigeria.
That's good.
And we went to the Oba Palace.
Yes.
Which, you know, as a youth, I grew up in Jamaica, and we hear about palace. Mm. We expect a certain look. But when we went to the Oba Palace, it was totally different from what we envisioned in our minds. You know, it's like a total different setting. But we know that there's a lot of history that comes out of Nigeria. Even now we see that the Yoruba tradition has taken hold of a lot of us in America and in the Caribbean here, even in Haiti, which we think is a big influence in Haiti, the Yoruba tradition. What says you?
The truth is that Benin is a tribe of very beautiful and proud people.
Yeah.
When first the colonialists came to Nigeria, the Benin said, they cannot allow, as you use words that are decent, they don't want to allow people who are not up to their level to take charge of their children, so they didn't send their children to the white man school in time. That's number one. Then number two, if you go into the origin and history of Benin, you will find that because the Benins never went to school in time, or both school, the white man school, the Yorubas went first and they tried to pervert history. I can authoritatively talk on this. In 1971, when the then Midwest State government that metamorphosed into Bende State sent me to University of Ife, now Obafemi Awolowo University, to direct a play with the late Olarotimi of Orame Nogbaisi, it was made clear that Ife was founded by a Benin prince.
Ife.
Ife.
You know,
Ife.
I performed at the university, yes. Ife University compound. Yes. We performed there, as I said, like when we went there. But, all right, I was mentioning the Yoruba tradition.
Yes.
Yeah. And I was saying that a lot, what I see almost, is there a retention of Yoruba culture in what we see now as voodoo?
Yes. Well, in Cuba, Brazil, Jamaica, and a few of the Caribbeans, the reason why they tend to retain Yoruba culture is not because it is superior to...
No, we're not talking about cultures. The superior. Yes. We're just asking if...
Yes.
Would you say that the Yoruba culture is embedded in the voodoo practice?
Well, not entirely, because no tribe in Nigeria can exist in isolation. They must, their components brought together to form a whole.
Yeah.
For instance, the type of voodoo you have in Yoruba land is not the type you have in Benin. I am a high priest and a native doctor of what we call bush doctor here.
Yeah, all right. Explain the difference between the voodoo of the Yoruba and the voodoo of Benin.
Okay.
Yeah.
The voodoo or the charms of the Yorubas, what makes it different from the that of the Benins is that, one, Olokun, for instance, the god of the sea, in Yoruba, is not well practiced as we practice it in Benin. They come to Benin and then we initiate them. Then the Oromila or Ifa, which we call Ake in Benin, with the Yorubas practice, if you go into the ritual details, you will find that there are some similarities, but they are not much, because the language difference made for the differences. The language and the culture make for the differences between the voodoo in Yoruba and the one in Benin. The Benins have caution in using deadly charms, except when it is ordained either by the Oba or the king, or certain ancestral deities or gods. You cannot. Whereas in Yoruba, everyone practices it in isolation and they can be used to harm. I think that's the area Haiti and a few other places inherited. Before a Benin man uses a deadly charm, it is with caution. I was telling a Jamaican man today, he saw a charm with me. I said, if I give you this thing and ask you to dry a tree on the spot, or ask a car to stop on the road, you will find that it happens immediately. But before I allow you to use it, I will make you to take an oath that you will never use it arbitrarily. Whereas in the Yoruba culture, it is not like that. So they can use it in isolation.
Yeah. Okay. This is the Cutting Edge and IRFM. We're going to explore tonight some different belief systems that a lot of Jamaicans, because we are so embedded in the Christian mindset, we are alienated from our ancestral roots. And this chief that we have in the studio here is going to carry us through that level of understanding about, well, we just start the difference between the Benin and the Yoruba tradition in terms of the practice, you'd say, the ritual practice.
Yes.
All right. The ritual practice, tell me some of the things then where you would have find in the Benin practice that is not Yoruba. And you must understand why I'm mentioning Yoruba, because most Jamaican people that is into this and tradition, ancestral thing, is more into the Yoruba tradition. So they are not exposed to the Benin tradition. So since you are from the Benin tradition, who I explain to Jamaican the difference, I mean, what makes the Benin system not so exposed as the Yoruba system?
Yes. The reason is, as I said earlier, the Benin up to today are still very secretive. My mother is 112 years old now. If she's teaching me medicine, what are you doing? It is not fire that would have produced wood ashes. So what I'm trying to say is that, one, the reason why Benin's own is not was not as popular as the Yoruba's own was that they did not want people to know about them.
Okay.
Two, they did not want people that are not from within us to know our secret medications or herbs. Mm-hmm. Up till tomorrow, the bronze casting in Benin is still restricted to a guild established by the Oba in about 500 BC.
Oh, yeah?
AD 500.
All right. The Yoruba, going back to the Yoruba people, I went to a ritual in North Carolina, where there was, not North Carolina, all right, that's what I remember, but they had this all-white ceremony that they we met on the beach before the sun rise, and they had all these rituals going on. But these were like Yoruba priests, Yoruba priestesses, and all these things. And I am seeing, and I also been to Haiti, and I say I've got to voodoo ceremonies, and we speak to voodoo priests and these things. And we went to Brazil also, and I realized that you're dressed similar to.
After a firefight, they killed Osama bin Laden and took custody of his body.
One of bin Laden's sons, two other men, and one woman were also killed in the attack. U.S. officials said bin Laden was buried at sea after a DNA test was conducted. At the time of his death, bin Laden was living in a heavily fortified mansion just a mile from the Pakistani Army's principal military academy. The U.S. operation was reportedly carried out by 25 Navy SEALs under the command of the Joint Special Operations Command. It's unclear what role Pakistan played in the killing. The Pakistan Taliban has threatened to attack Pakistani leaders, army, and the United States after the bin Laden killing. Meanwhile, the U.S. Army has increased security levels at all of its bases and installations. Crowds began gathering outside the White House and at Ground Zero late last night, celebrating the news of bin Laden's death. This is Jake DiLiberto, a Marine Corps veteran who fought in Afghanistan and Iraq.
We've been chasing this ghost bin Laden around Afghanistan and Iraq and Pakistan and Yemen and everywhere else. And finally, we can bring back, bring our troops home. We can use the rule of law to protect our borders against another terrorist attack or something like this. But we don't need to be sending our troops and invading other countries anymore. And today's a good day for us.
Osama bin Laden was shot in the head and buried at sea. We'll have more on his death after headlines. The killing of Osama bin Laden comes as Taliban-led militants announced a springtime offensive in Afghanistan, killing at least 11 people on Sunday. In one attack, a suicide bomber said to be 12 years old killed four people. The Taliban has warned civilians to stay away from public gatherings, military bases, and convoys, as well as government offices. In news from Libya, NATO forces bomb Muammar Gaddafi's compound Saturday, killing his 29-year-old son, Saif al-Arab, and three of his grandchildren, all of whom were under the age of 12. Gaddafi was reportedly inside the compound at the time of the attack. Democratic Congress member Denis Kucinich condemned the NATO attack, saying, quote, NATO's leaders have blood on their hands. NATO's airstrike seems to have been intended to carry out an illegal policy of assassination. Another NATO airstrike damaged a Libyan preschool for children with Down syndrome and two government buildings. Hours after the attack, backers of the Libyan government set fire to the vacant British and Italian embassies in Tripoli, as well as the U.S. Commercial and Consular Affairs Department. Following the fires, the United Nations evacuated its international staff from Tripoli. Meanwhile, the Libyan city of Misrata remains under siege. There are reports Gaddafi has ordered Libyan naval vessels to mine Misrata harbor and has threatened to attack any ships that brought food or medicine to the residents of the besieged city. In a televised address to the nation last night, President Barack Obama announced Al-Qaeda leader Osama bin Laden had been killed by U.S. forces in Pakistan. Bin Laden was killed on Sunday in a U.S. operation in the Pakistani city of Abbottabad, about 60 miles north of the capital, Islamabad.
Tonight, I can report to the American people and to the world that the United States has conducted an operation that killed Osama bin Laden, the leader of Al-Qaeda, and a terrorist who's responsible for the murder of thousands of innocent men, women, and children.
Osama bin Laden was shot in the head and buried at sea. The Saudi-born leader of Al-Qaeda is believed to be the mastermind of the attacks on New York and Washington on September 11, 2001, as well as a number of other attacks around the world. Osama bin Laden's death raises questions about the future of the U.S. war on terror and whether U.S. policy in the region will change. Almost 10 years ago, on October 7, 2001, the U.S. invaded Afghanistan. In an attempt to capture bin Laden and destroy his Al-Qaeda network, the war in Afghanistan has since become the longest in U.S. history and has resulted in tens of thousands of deaths. For years, the U.S. has also waged a secret war inside Pakistan. Despite the killing of Osama bin Laden, Australian Prime Minister Julia Gillard said today the war on terror will continue.
Can I say too about the death of Osama bin Laden that whilst Al-Qaeda has been hurt today, Al-Qaeda is not finished. Our war against terrorism must continue. We continue to be engaged in Afghanistan so that that country does not again become a haven for terrorists. That work will need to continue. That work has already cost Australian lives, but that work is vital, and we will continue the mission in Afghanistan.
To discuss the death of Osama bin Laden, we're joined by a number of guests. We'll be speaking with Robert Fisk on the phone in Beirut. Robert Fisk, the longtime Middle East correspondent of the Independent newspaper in London, he was the first Western journalist to interview Osama bin Laden. We're also joined in New York by Jeremy Scahill, Puffin Foundation writing fellow at the Nation Institute, author of Blackwater, The Rise of the World's Most Powerful Mercenary Army. He blogs at thenation.com. We're also joined by Alan Nairn, an award-winning investigative journalist and activist. In London, we're joined by Tariq Ali, the well-known author, Pakistani-born commentator. We're going to start with Jeremy Scahill. Jeremy, tell us what you understand. You have been following Jason.
Pakistan was the culmination of the life's work of General Stanley McChrystal, who headed the Joint Special Operations Command from 2003 to 2008, and was the man tasked by the Bush administration with leading a global assassination campaign of people that the administration determined to be high-value targets or terrorist threats or militant threats to the United States. The current commander of JSOC is Admiral William McRaven, who himself is a former Navy SEAL. And this really is the most elite force within the U.S. military. The individuals who we believe actually killed Osama bin Laden are reportedly members of Navy SEAL Team 6, also known as the Development Group. And those are probably the most elite forces in the world. General Barry McCaffrey said these are the most dangerous people on planet Earth. This operation was carried out by a drone that was overhead, 25 SEALs, and then shooters that allegedly stormed this compound. the role of JSOC within the broader U.S. So-called war on terror has been a surgical strike force. So I think you have the one story playing out, which is how this happened. And it does sound like there was some incredible detective work that took place in tracking this courier who was Osama bin Laden's go-to to communicate with the outside world. For 5 years, they were reportedly tracking the developments at this compound. Interesting, this compound is a stone's throw away from a Pakistani military academy. And just days ago, General Kayani, the head of Pakistan's armed forces, actually was basically a block away from Osama bin Laden, if all of these reports are true. On the other side of this, though, I think there's another reaction. I found it quite disgusting to see people chanting like it was some sort of sporting event outside of the White House. I think it was idiotic. Let's remember here, hundreds of thousands of people have died. Iraq was invaded, a country that had nothing to do with al-Qaeda, nothing to do with Osama bin Laden. The United States created an al-Qaeda presence in Iraq by invading it, made Iran a far more influential force in Iraq than it ever would have been. We have given a grand motivation to people around the world that want to do harm to Americans in our killing of civilians, our waging of war against countries that have no connection to al-Qaeda, and by staying in these countries long after the mission was accomplished. Al-Qaeda was destroyed in Afghanistan, forced on the run. The Taliban have no chance of retaking power in Afghanistan. And so I think that this is a somber day where we should be remembering all of the victims, the 3,000 people that died in the United States, and then the hundreds of thousands that died afterwards as a result of a U.S. response to this that should have been a law enforcement response and instead was to declare war on the world.
Can you talk, Jeremy, about what you understand did take place in this not place in the frontier and the right. border, the tribal lands between Pakistan and Afghanistan, but in a mansion in a city of 500,000 next to a military academy?
This is a very big problem for Pakistan's government. Because had Osama bin Laden been captured in an area that the Pakistani government didn't have control of, there would have been a very different narrative that would have unfolded. You already see right-wing commentators, former Bush officials, really ratcheting up their rhetoric about Pakistan and the fact that he was captured in what was essentially a town equivalent to Vail, Colorado, a vacation town, really shows that he must have had some sort of protection from the Pakistani state in order to live for so long, at least 5 years, it seems, in this location, rather than being in a cave somewhere. The way that this operation went down, if in fact it is confirmed that it was the Joint Special Operations Command coming in from Afghanistan, goes back to an agreement that General McChrystal brokered with then-President Pervez Musharraf of Pakistan that allowed what was called the Hot Pursuit Clause, which authorized U.S. Special Operations Forces to go into Pakistan from Afghanistan if they were in pursuit of Osama bin Laden or other al-Qaeda leaders. And the agreement was that the U.S. could do those operations as long as the Pakistani government could then deny it. And so it seems as though this operation was at least in part launched from Afghanistan into Pakistan, President Obama chairing five National Security Council meetings about this specific operation. So I think that, there's going to be a lot of celebrating within the special ops community for having taken down the man that was identified as the number one target of this operation. And it shows that President Obama has really continued and doubled down on the Bush administration policy of target assassination, leading the way in terms of America's response to al-Qaeda and to people it designates as so-called terrorists.
And the news of how Osama bin Laden died?
Well, that's interesting. Alan and I were talking before the show about this, and I'd be interested in hearing what he has to say. The phrasing that President Obama used was very interesting. I mean, we'll have to see before I think we give any detailed commentary on it. They said there was a firefight there. They said someone used a woman as a human shield at some point during the operation. It sounds like Osama bin Laden was shot in the head. Navy SEALs are the most highly trained forces within the U.S. military. It wouldn't be surprising that they could sniper shoot him from a distance and hit him dead between his eyes. Maybe something else went down. We don't know what happened inside of that compound, but it does sound like he was shot directly in the head.
And buried at sea.
And then they say buried at sea. I'm not sure exactly what that means, if they took him down deep into the sea and buried him or if they just dumped his body. I mean, we don't know.
We're going to go to break and come back, and we'll be joined by Talat Hamdani. Talat Hamdani lost her son, 9/11. She is the mother of Mohammed Salman Hamdani. This is is Democracy Now!, democracynow.org, the War and Peace Report. We'll also be joined by Matthew Ho, highest level diplomat to have quit amidst the war in Afghanistan. War by Edwin Starr. This is Democracy Now!, democracynow.org, the War and Peace Report. I'm Amy Goodman. The news of this day, of this weekend, the news right now coming out of not only Washington, D.C., but around the world, Osama bin Laden is dead. Talat Hamdani is our guest right now, mother of Mohammed Salman Hamdani. Mohammed Salman Hamdani died in the 9/11 attacks at the World Trade Center. He was 23 years old. She's a member of the group September 11th Families for Peaceful Tomorrow. She's joining us by phone from Long Island. Her son, a police cadet who raced to World Trade Center to try to save people. He was working at Rockefeller University. And before they knew it, while their son had died a hero, the New York Post and others were suggesting that he was a terrorist, that he was responsible for what had taken place. Well, all that changed when his remains were found, and the police commissioner, the mayor, and others attended his funeral. And Mohammed Salman Hamdani is named in the USA Patriot Act. Talat Hamdani, your response to the news that Osama bin Laden is dead?
It is a relief that finally, after 10 long years, justice has been done to all those people that died on 9/11. And also the hope is that we will move forward as a united country as well as globally united towards the path of peace and justice instead of the past 10 years that we have been on revenge and killing. We also have to keep in mind, as a country, we need to lead by example, and our rule of law and our civil liberties and our constitution has since 9/11 has happened has been very strained, and hopefully we will go back to our original values, and not only in domestic policies, but for policies abroad also.
Talat Hamdani, your family, your other sons, their thoughts today? Your husband has since died.
Yes, my one son, he does not get involved. He doesn't express himself, so to say. My younger one, he said he's happy because this man not only killed his mother, but killed his father also. And he did give a statement yesterday. So, yes, he's happy. There is a sense of, people are expressing as they went down to Ground Zero and at the Times Square. It's a closure. It was something that the whole world was waiting for. More importantly, people who died that day and their families were waiting for. So a big sense, a big relief. And one message I would really, like to give, that no matter who our enemy is and no matter what part of the world they are in, there is no refuge for them. No, we will find them out. America will find them out and bring them to justice.
Talat Hamdani, I want to thank you for being with us, joining us from Long Island, New York. Lost her son, Salman Hamdani, in the 9/11 attacks. We're going right now to Islamabad, to the journalist Musharraf Zaidi, who was tweeting yesterday, early before all this news came out, asking questions like, why was a U.S. helicopter down? We're hoping that we have him on the line. Mohammed Zaidi. It looks like we just lost him. We'll try to get him in a minute. Tariq Ali is with us in Britain. Tariq, your response to what has taken place?
Amy, what is quite astonishing is that it took them such a long time. The news is that he was in a safe house, which is literally next door to the Kakul Military Academy, one of the most heavily protected areas in the country. And the notion that this was a secret from Pakistan's military intelligence is risible. It's just not believable. I think the fact that he was there, the fact that they knew he was there. So the question that is intriguing me is how this I don't believe that. I think that the information came from within Pakistan's military intelligence, and what was the pressure put to get it from them? I think the Pakistanis were informed that this was going to happen. The Pakistan's leadership was already, with pat answers, celebrating the event. The Prime Minister, Zardari, Karzai in Kabul. So I think they had been planning it. The timing is a mystery, why they did it exactly at this moment, given that they've known that he was there. So that's my first reaction. The second reaction is, of course, as Jeremy has also said, that it's far better when these things are done legally. Because to show that state terrorism is more powerful than individual terrorism is bizarre. I mean, everyone knows that. The United States is more powerful than virtually the rest of the world put together, so we don't need a demonstration of that. What we needed, which Obama didn't talk about, was why wasn't he captured alive? They could have done that if they knew where he was. The Pakistanis could have been told to do that and tried in a court of law. That would have been genuinely educative and revelatory to try him, to prove him guilty, and then to imprison him, or whatever.
But
they didn't go down that route.
Tariq, we've just gotten Musharraf Zaidi on, and I want to make sure we get him in from Islamabad. Musharraf, you were early on tweeting that a U.S. helicopter had gone down yesterday. This is before we knew anything about Osama bin Laden being dead. What is the latest you understand, especially of Pakistani involvement in the killing of Osama bin Laden? And what is the reaction today in Islamabad?
Oh, thanks, Amy. I'm actually driving from Abbottabad to Islamabad right now, after having spent the better part of the day there. The helicopter fell on during the operation on the compound of a little plot of land on which bin Laden was living. There was there's been an implicit denial by the Pakistani government in its official statement.
Continent!
You know, Pakistan being intricately involved in this. But the notion of there not having been any involvement by Pakistan in this, it rings nonsensical and a little bit far-fetched. The city Abbottabad is a garrison town. It was founded by a British major in 1853. It's kind of a hill station. A lot of people enjoy the weather there during the summers, and so people have sort of a dual residence. Abbottabad itself is the largest urban area between the Punjab province, which is the largest province in Pakistan, and Khyber Pakhtunkhwa province, which is the province, it's the Pakhtun province, it's the province in which so much of the security that's been happening in Pakistan is sourced. The specific neighborhood is a reasonably sort of middle class, upper middle class neighborhood. The house is said to have been electronically fenced and well guarded. The idea that bin Laden got from Tora Bora to that house over the last 7 or 8 years without a single element of the Pakistani state knowing about it, it just doesn't ring true. What rings even more hollow is the notion that somehow U.S. military choppers, gunships could fly into Pakistan undetected by the radars and hover above the house, have one of the choppers crash, have another chopper end up there, kill bin Laden, take a few of the people there, capture them and fly them away. And all of this could happen without any coordination, any kind of approval, any kind of data or information sharing with the Pakistani security establishment, with the Pakistani state. It just sounds like a flight of somebody's fancy.
And the plane that went down yesterday, the helicopter, the U.S. helicopter, though they said no one died in that crash?
That's right. We heard that there were no casualties. Nobody, as far as I know, nobody's actually seen the wreckage so far. People did hear a massive blast, and the reports locally and internationally were that a helicopter had fallen there. Originally, we were told that that helicopter was a Pakistani helicopter. Today, it's the line has been that it's that there were both U.S. helicopters. Sources in Pakistan that are reasonably trustworthy confirmed that they're U.S. helicopters. Some people say two, others say four. The compound itself, the location where this happened, and the fact that, you know, a helicopter went down, allegedly a helicopter went down, suggests that, you know, this was a significant operation that would have been possible without the support of parts of the Pakistani state.
Jeremy Scahill.
Also, on the issue of the helicopter, I mean, we understand that it was what's called a Little Bird helicopter, which is a very lightweight helicopter that Blackwater types and JSOC types have often used in Iraq and to an extent in Afghanistan. The reports are that it was then destroyed by the U.S. forces after it went down, and the official line is that it was a mechanical failure. There are other reports that say that it was brought down by some kind of arms fire from within the compound. I mean, we probably won't know that. I would concur with what Musharraf is saying. I mean, the idea that U.S. Special Ops forces are operating in Pakistan without the knowledge of the Pakistani government is, in fact, ludicrous. And that's why when this deal was originally brokered by Musharraf and McChrystal, the public posture had to be that the Pakistanis would deny it. Let's remember, too, that this killing of Osama bin Laden takes place just months after Raymond Davis, who was a man who straddled the world of both the CIA and Special Operations Forces, killed two men in Lahore, Pakistan. And then after weeks of controversy, was eventually taken out of the country after payments were made to the families of his victims. One of the things that Raymond Davis is suspected of having done inside of Pakistan was having communications with people in the tribal areas, but also potentially targeting Lashkar-e-Taiba, which is a terrorist organization behind the Mumbai bombings that has been designated by the U.S. as a state sponsor of terrorism, and that the U.S. accuses of having very close ties to the ISI. So the timing of this operation coming as soon as it did after this epic scandal with Raymond Davis, perhaps the most serious crisis between Pakistan and U.S. governments in a decade, or maybe even since the ransacking of the U.S. embassy in Islamabad in 1979, is curious to say the least. But I think there's two questions here. Were the Pakistanis giving sanctuary to Osama bin Laden in this town that Musharraf has just described, a heavily populated town with big military presence? And what was the full role of the Pakistani government in ultimately killing Osama bin Laden?
And how could this, this sort of quite grand operation and ostensibly successful operation that taken place, people feel a little bit starstruck by the fact that the eyes and ears of the world are now very intently focused on the city of Ahmedabad.
I wanted to bring Alan Nairn into this conversation. Your response to the news and what you think this could mean. Could this mean the end of the U.S. war with Afghanistan?
I don't think it will. It should. It definitely should be an occasion for rethinking everything on a much bigger scale than Afghanistan. The first thing that struck me was seeing the Americans out in the streets celebrating outside the White House, outside the old World Trade Center site, people cheering, people exultant. And while some of that may come from bloodlust, I think a lot of it comes from a sense of justice. People like justice. They want to see it. And in this case, I think many people have the feeling, well, he got what he deserved. This was a man who had massacred civilians. He got what he deserved. And there's a lot of truth to that. But if we recognize that someone who is willing to kill civilians en masse someone who is willing to send young people out with weapons and bombs to, as President Obama put it, see to it that a family doesn't have a loved one sitting at the dinner table anymore, see to it that a child and a parent never meet again. If we say that someone like that deserves to die, then we have to follow through on that idea. And we have to recognize, okay, if these things really are so enormous, we have to stop them. Killing bin Laden does not stop them. Bin Laden is dead, but the world is still governed by bin Ladens. People cheer because they thought they saw justice, but this was not justice delivered by, a kind of rough justice delivered by victims. This was one killer killing another. A big killer, the United States government, killing another, someone who's actually a smaller one, bin Laden. And the bin Laden doctrine that to take out the CIA office that was at the World Trade Center, it's okay to blow up the whole World Trade Center. To teach Americans a lesson, it's okay to slaughter thousands of Americans. That doctrine lives on in the American White House, in the American Pentagon. You know, every day, and in seats of authority all over the world, every day the U.S., directly with its own forces, or indirectly through its proxy forces, its clients, is killing at a minimum dozens of people. I mean, just since Obama came in the one limited area of drone strikes in Pakistan, something like 1,900 have been killed just under Obama. And that started decades before 9/11. We have to stop these people. These powerful people like Obama, like Bush, like those who run the Pentagon, and who think it's okay to take civilian life. And it doesn't seem that they can be stopped by normal routine politics. Because under the American system, as in most other systems, people don't even know this is happening. People know the face of bin Laden. They know the evil deeds that he's done. They see that he's dead, and they say, oh, great, we killed bin Laden. But they don't see the other 20, 30, 50, 100 people who the U.S. killed that day. Many of them children, many of them civilians. If they did, they probably wouldn't be out in the street cheering about those deaths. You know, we've got to stop this practice. And Americans aren't doing it. Egyptians, Tunisians are doing their part. They've risen up against the repression they face. I think we need an American uprising if we're to put a stop to this kind of killing of innocent people. And we need an American Romero. Someone like Archbishop Romero of Salvador.
Yeah, this is the Cutting Edge on IRFM. We was just tuning into a debate about this recent thing that is happening in the world now that seem to go and to take the interests of all of us. And this man who just finished said a proper thing to end this debate here, that killers killing killers. I'm talking about killers killing killers. And even though we know about the killings of bin Laden because of his publicity, yet still, this man, this American is telling you that America is killing children daily and people daily. So he's saying that killers killing killers, when we're going to stop it. So, as we said, this going to continue again and again and again, because there's so much other things left to be revealed that we still don't know. And them kill Bin Laden, because if he was to talk, we know what would happen if them did allow him to live. Yes, we know what would happen. But this is the Cutting Edge on IRFM. You know, say, we come with things and different things and different things. Tonight, we have a special, special guest inside of the studio here. We never announce him because it come up. And we couldn't afford for make this man leave Jamaica and don't present him to the Jamaican people. And also, it's a pity we never shoot the television series yet, because it would be really nice to have him on the television too. But then again, it's so it go. But the rest of the night, we're going to spend with, you know, say, we don't want to call him name wrong. We don't want to call him name wrong, because we don't feel when somebody call my name wrong. It's Ibon. Ibon. Eh?
Hello.
Ebo On.
Yeah.
From Nigeria.
Yes.
All right. We have Ebo On. I don't even want to call the first day. I'm afraid to call the first day, you know, because I don't want to. Osemwege.
You are correct.
Osemwege.
Yeah.
All right. See there? But no, it's been African for a long time. Osemwege Ebo On.
Yes.
All right. Ibo.
As long as you call me a human being's name, I will answer.
Okay. No, I would I'm just... No, no, I'm saying yes. Ibo. No.
Not at all.
Yoruba.
Just call me Ida Egi.
Egi.
That's...
Okay. Yes.
Yes.
Well, you said I'll call you either Eggy. Okay, so I can call you Eggy then.
Eggy. Although it will be an abomination if you call me that in Benin or Nigeria.
Well, I don't want to call you something that's abomination in Nigeria.
Okay, call me Chief.
Chief, yes. Ebo On.
Chief Ebo On.
Chief Ebo On.
Yes.
All right, you are a chief in which state?
Osemwege Ebo On.
You're a chief in which state?
Chief Ebo On.
In which state in Nigeria?
Edo State. Benin Kingdom.
All right.
It's the oldest kingdom on earth.
All right. You know, I spent a month in Bendel State.
Yeah, I was told.
Yeah, I spent a month there in 1982.
Yeah.
My first trip to Africa was to Nigeria.
That's good.
And we went to the Oba Palace.
Yes.
Which... You know, as a youth, I grew up in Jamaica, and we hear about palace. Mm. We expect a certain look, but when we went to the Oba Palace, it was totally different from what we envisioned in our minds. Mm. You know, it's like a total different setting. But we know that there's a lot of history that comes out of Nigeria. Even now, we see that the Yoruba tradition has taken all of a lot of us in America and in the Caribbean here, even in Haiti, which we think is a big influence in Haiti, the Yoruba tradition. What says you?
The truth is that Benin is a tribe of very beautiful and proud people.
Yeah.
When first the colonialists came to Nigeria, the Benin said they cannot allow, I should use words that are decent, they don't want to allow people who are not up to their level to take charge of their children, so they didn't send their children to the white man's school in time.
Mm-hmm.
That's number one. Then number two, if you go into the origin and history of Benin, you will find that because the Benins never went to school in time, or both school, the white man's school, the Yorubas went first and they tried to pervert history. I can authoritatively talk on this. In 1971, when the then Midwest State government that metamorphosed into Bender State sent me to University of Ife, now Obafemi Awolowo University, to direct a play with the late Olarotimi of Orane Nogbaisi, it was made clear that Ife was founded by a Benin prince.
Ife.
Ife.
You know,
Ife.
I performed at the university, yes. Ife University compound. Yes. We performed there. As I said, like when we went there. But, all right, I was mentioning the Yoruba tradition.
Yes.
Yeah. And I was saying that a lot, what I see almost, is there a retention of Yoruba culture in what we see now as voodoo?
Yes. Well, in Cuba, Brazil, Jamaica, and a few of the Caribbeans, the reason why they tend to retain Yoruba culture is not because it is superior to...
No, no, we're not talking about the superior. Yes. We're just asking if...
Yes.
Would you say that the Yoruba culture is embedded in the voodoo practice?
Well, not entirely, because no tribe in Nigeria can exist in isolation. Mm-hmm. Their components brought together to form a whole.
Yeah.
For instance, the type of voodoo you have in Yoruba land is not the type you have in Benin. I am a high priest and a native doctor of what we call bush doctor here.
Yeah, all right. Explain the difference between the voodoo of the Yoruba and the voodoo of Benin.
Okay. Yeah. The voodoo or the charms of the Yorubas, what makes it different from that of the Benins is that one, Olokun, for instance, the god of the sea, in Yoruba, is not well practiced as we practice it in Benin. They come to Benin and then we initiate them. Then the Oromila or Ifa, which we call Ake in Benin, with the Yorubas practice, if you go into the ritual details, you will find that there are some similarities, but they are not much, because the language difference made for the differences. Mm. The language and the culture make for the differences between the voodoo in Yoruba and the one in Benin. The Benins have caution in using deadly charms, except when it is ordained either by the Oba or the king, or certain ancestral deities or gods. You cannot. Whereas in Yoruba, everyone practices it in isolation and they can be used to harm. I think that's the area Haiti and a few other places inherited.
Mm.
Before a Benin man uses a deadly charm, it is with caution. I was telling a Jamaican man today, he saw a charm with me. I said, if I give you this thing and ask you to dry a tree on the spot, or ask a car to stop on the road, you will find that it happens immediately. But before I allow you to use it, I will make you to take an oath that you will never use it arbitrarily. Whereas in the Yoruba culture, it is not like that. So they can use it in isolation.
Yeah. Okay. This is the Cutting Edge and IRFM. We're going to explore tonight some different belief systems that a lot of Jamaicans, because we are so embedded in the Christian mindset, we are alienated from our ancestral roots. And this chief that we have in the studio here is going to carry us through that level of understanding about, well, we just start the difference between the Benin and the Yoruba tradition in terms of the practice. You'd say the ritual practice.
Yes.
All right. The ritual practice. Tell me some of the things then where you would have find in the Benin practice that is not Yoruba. And you must understand why I'm mentioning Yoruba, because most Jamaican people that is into this and tradition, ancestral thing, is more into the Yoruba tradition. So they are not exposed to the Benin tradition. So since you are from the Benin tradition, who I explain to Jamaican the difference, I mean, what makes the Benin system not so exposed as the Yoruba system?
Yes. The reason is, as I said earlier, the Benins up to today are still very secretive. My mother is 112 years old now. If she's teaching me medicine, what are you doing? It is not fire that would have produced wood ashes. So what I'm trying to say is that, one, the reason why Benin's own is not was not as popular as the Yoruba's own was that they did not want people to know about them.
Okay.
Two, they did not want people that are not from within us to know our secret medications or herbs. Mm-hmm. Up till tomorrow, the bronze casting in Benin is still restricted to a guild established by the Oba in about 500 BC.
Oh, yeah?
AD 500.
All right. The Yoruba, going back to the Yoruba people, I went to a ritual in North Carolina, where there was, not North Carolina, that's who I remember, but they had this all-white ceremony that we met on the beach before the sun rise. And they had all these rituals going on. But these were like Yoruba priests, Yoruba priestesses and all these things. And I am seeing, and I also been to Haiti. And I say, I've got to voodoo ceremonies, and we speak to voodoo priests and these things. And we went to Brazil also. And I realized that you dress similar to
just many centuries ago, over a century and a half ago. And the titles in Lagos and some other parts of Nigeria are Benin titles. You go in Lagos, when you go to Nigeria, you will see Oshodi Street. That is from Benin, Oshodi Street. It's a title in Benin.
Yeah.
Ashogmo, Abaluaye, those are Benin titles, corrupted.
Yeah.
So it's the same thing with our in fact, I always don't want to use the words voodoo, paganism, and others because they do not align with me. Voodoo is a very bad name given to our traditional medicine by the colonialists because they don't want to see anything good in the black man.
Yeah.
So the same thing with paganism, given to our religion. Paganism is not an African religion. It is in the
European,
West.
European, yeah.
The same thing with Satan. Satan is not a native of Africa.
Yeah. Yeah, we didn't have no Satan in Africa.
Satan is Esu. We worship Esu, E-S-U.
Yeah.
We worship him, and God respects him because he helps to administer the universe.
All right, explain that. Explain.
Okay. Esu.
What Europeans would have said devil?
They call him devil or Satan.
That is in European
European context.
All right. So you say the Benin people worship this.
Not only the Benins, most Africans worship him. In Yoruba, they worship Eshu.
All right.
When you establish Oromila, Eshu is the next to go with it, because he is a fighter.
Mm-hmm.
In my center, I have two. I have one in the street. I have one in the garden of the gods. I think it's in Job chapter 3. It said, God sat and with all his children, and amongst them was Satan.
Mm-hmm.
Satan is a Esu. The whites or whatever West worship him. But they try to call our own Satan to give a dog a bad name in order to kill it.
Yeah, yeah.
So we worship Esu.
So what do you look to Esu for?
When we are preparing for war, we beg Esu to get ready and remove all the dangers on our way.
Mm-hmm.
If anything is happening in a person's life and there are detractors, there are enemies, we send Esu to go and remove those problems.
Mm-hmm.
For instance, a woman is pregnant and they say he's going to have cesarean. Then we go to Esu shrine, we will
tear a plantain, use rope to sew it, put needles, put knife, put oil, and tell Eshu, don't allow this, our daughter, to be operated or not upon.
Wait. Stick yes. up. You go fast. Because okay. we want to keep this now.
Okay.
You say, if a woman is going to have cesarean birth,
yes.
you go to Eshu.
You will go to Eshu.
And to do what?
To tell him to prevent that cesarean operation.
Okay. So what you do now to prevent that?
What we do is, there are things, when you are going to Eshu to do anything, depending on what you are going for. If you are going to war, you will use different things. But this particular case, you will take oil, red oil, palm oil,
yes.
to prevent bleeding.
Yes.
Then you will take rope and needle, you cut a plantain, the green plantain, tear it and sew it together. Plantain represents a human being in this case. Then you use rope to sew it. Mm-hmm. Then you mold an effigy of a woman to represent that woman they are supposed to be cutting. Then you put a knife, you put it and say, don't allow this woman to be touched with these things. Then you will use the knife to touch her belly. You use the needle to touch it. Then she delivers safely without any surgical exploration.
And this is something that is practiced amongst your people.
Not only my people, I don't want to exaggerate. My people Yoruba, do it. The Yorubas do it.
Yorubas do it. Yes. In Nigeria, they practice this. For, and, for thousands, hundreds of years.
Yeah. And there are other ways. For instance, if you bring a pregnant woman here and she says she's bleeding or she's going to be given a surgical, a cesarean operation, all I need to do is either I use my left toe to touch the chest from between the breast down to the navel, it will deliver that baby without having any cesarean.
No, explain that, because people are listening to this. All right, see, this way I say,
yes.
this kind of sounds strange to Jamaican people, you know.
Yes.
Because a muta brings some voodoo man, wobia man, for the real, you know.
Yes.
Which, me love these things, you understand? So, me not yes. really business where people ask, but me yes. want here now. You say, if a woman
is pregnant and they say she's going to have cesarean,
yes.
then all you need to do, you use your right or left toe, depending on the baby in the womb, because under the navel, you can scan with the third eye or with traditional eye and know whether the woman is going to have a baby or not. I will teach you and teach the Jamaicans listening. You know the navel.
Yeah.
You will tell the woman to remove cloth. You bend down. There is a black line. If it goes to the right, it means she's going to have a boy. If it goes to the left, it means she's going to have a girl. If it's going to be a girl, use the left toe. If a boy, use the right toe. Use it from the chest down and say, it is the road, the porcupine, enters the hole that it comes out. This woman, if you produce it in the day or in the afternoon or in the night, there will be no cesarean. That is one aspect. Then you can also, the leaf, I saw it at Mount Kare, or Kerry, they call it, because I was there last year. Today, last year, I was there.
Yeah.
For a memorial ceremony of Reverend Myra Samuels. So, you plug the leaf, squeeze it like this.
Which leaf? What leaf? What
I don't know the name in Jamaica.
No, you tell me the African name. Tell me
if I give you the African name, I'm revealing the secret that we were talking. Anyway, okay, for the benefit of that, let me just, for authenticity and the authority, I will tell you. It's called Okika.
Okika.
And the name is in that book you are seeing now. The botanical name is
no,
in that
trust
book.
Trust me, I go and read this book.
And it's in that red book too. The botanical name is in a life too.
Yes, yes.
So you look at it, the Okika.
Yes.
So you squeeze it and say three words. Oki mwesagen, oki mwesagen, oki mwesagen. Put it in the mouth of the woman in between. Then give her one part to insert into her body. Then you will do this. Okay, mwesagen, 7 times. Flip on it, flip it. No blood will come out during that. When they see the table, in some hospitals in my state, they will say, did you go to drink a bohon small pot if they don't see blood on the table and things like that?
Yeah.
So those are some of the
and
things.
And this is something that you have done.
Yeah.
You have done this. You have done this operation.
I did it in Mount Carmel last year. A lady
drove a car into the compound, and I told them that that lady is going to collapse now. The lady is hearing as I'm talking now. The person that were there, with the persons that were there are hearing as I'm talking. So I said, she's going to collapse. Is bleeding, is bleeding. So they called. I said, are you bleeding? Say yes. I said, what? He said, they gave her so many antibiotics in there. I said, you are dying. Yeah. So I quickly went to that lift, gave her. I said, sit down. In less than 5 minutes, the blood stopped. I'm not talking theory. If you want to experiment it tomorrow, bring somebody, I do it. If it doesn't work, then you know I'm a liar.
Well, you have to call me out. This is the Cutting Edge, and I
remember.
Bendel State?
Yeah, no, it's not. It has been divided into two political states, the Edo and Delta states.
Yeah, okay.
The former Bendel State is now Edo and Delta states.
All right. You know, you just catch the audience a while ago, and a sister called and asked me a question to ask you, right?
Yeah.
You know, say, we just start the program, and it's like, yeah, you know, all right. The sister said, you was mentioning about if it is a girl, the line go one way, and if it's a boy, the line.
She's, you know the navel?
Yes.
The navel.
Yeah, there's a black spot.
No, the navel.
Yeah, yeah.
Under it, there is a line.
Yes.
Almost getting to where you have the hairs.
Yes.
Then if it goes to the left, it's a girl.
Yes.
If it goes to the right, it's a boy.
All right. She's asking, suppose it's a twin, a girl and a boy.
Okay. If it's a twin, the two lines will double in the middle. Or the two twins will go to left, which means the two are girls.
Yeah.
Or the two twins will go to right, which means they are boys.
But if it's in the middle, it's a girl
if
and a boy.
If they are a boy and a girl, the straight line going will split to two instead of one.
Yes.
One will go right, one will go left.
Okay.
Then it means they are... Okay. Yeah.
So it's like a Y. It's a up. It's like an upside down Y.
No, tomorrow, look for a pregnant woman. Say,
I look for a pregnant woman.
No. I'm a traditional gynecologist.
I'm a pregnant woman.
It's the line on the wire you are having now. It's just straight down on
I understand. I'm just picturing it. It's like this.
Yes, if it is
it's like
a boy and girl.
Upside down Y.
Yes.
It comes straight, it starts straight, and then it's split.
Yes.
Yes.
Yeah.
That's very interesting.
But if the children have problem in the womb, like if they are going to be stillbirth, or they have attack from the human world, those lines may be deceitful.
Mm.
For instance, if you are going to produce the child with the umbilical cord around the neck, which is going to mean either a Rasta or a Shango child, those lines may not be like that, so that they don't say, so I'm explaining it in details now.
Mm-hmm.
If they are not simple births, if it's going to be born a child to worship Shango, who is going to have hairs on his or her head, the lines will not be so. And those heads in Benin, we call it Iyaga, not a Rasta or what you call it in Jamaica.
Yeah.
It's called Iyaga. And you don't just pull scissors and cut it. If you put the hand that cut it, it's like the eyes that saw the egg of a parrot. They must be closed. They will be blind forever.
All right. Is it true that if a child is born with locks in this tradition.
Yeah.
They are worshipped.
They are what?
Worshipped. There's some powers that is designated to this child if she's born with what we call locks.
Yes, I know it. This If the child is born like that, there are two reasons for it.
Yeah.
One, he or she is going to be a priest to the god of thunder. Shango. Yes. Yeah. And twins are usually worshippers of Shango too. But if they have that dreadlock, you don't just go there and cut it and the child will have problems and the person that shaved it will have problems.
Mm.
If the child is not lucky, he may die. If he doesn't die, they will continue to carry him from one herbalist to the other. So what you do are many.
Mm.
Since my brothers and sisters here,
are likely, they have them at times. If you want locks, it's not everything I will be talking here. It will make me mean. So there are, you can't just go there. You can't just go there and cut it. There are certain things, rituals to be performed
before you cut it.
Before you cut it.
Yes.
All right.
Yeah. So what is the symbolism in the Benin tradition of the locks? I know you say what is the symbolism?
The symbolism is Agbiyaga. Is that she is, he or she is born to be a worshipper of the Shango. And immediately the parents must get the materials and give her the primary initiation into the God of Thunder cult.
All right. What is the benefits of this worshipping of God of Thunder, Shango? What is the benefit?
The benefit?
Yeah.
Okay. I understand now. I'm happy you know that when you talk fast, I won't understand it.
Yes.
The benefits are many, but the first Shango is a revenger. Like places where, you see, a child does not know the king of dogs. He will say, oh, this a dog with plenty of hairs. So what happens is, if Shango is recognized, it can prevent hurricane, it can prevent what you had in Alabama or so, the tornado.
Yeah.
It can prevent it.
Yeah.
But principally and primarily, Shango to the worshippers. One, revenge. If you do anything bad to me and I invoke the soul of Shango, the day the thunder will peal, result will come out.
Yeah.
For instance, if before you come tomorrow, they steal one of your microphones, then you will say, look, I say, okay, I have the stone with me in my hotel. I will use it to touch my tongue, put it down, put all the ritual things we curse. The body, the blood will be boiling in him.
The thief.
Yeah. If he doesn't confess in time, the day the thunder will peel, is struck down.
All right. What is the connection between that ritual and the thief? The connection. This ritual.
Yes.
With the stone and thing. What is the connection between? What is happening?
Okay.
There. That is vibration. The vibration. Yeah. You see. Between the thief.
Those electric wires they have outside. Mm-hmm. Not the tiny ones, the ones that when anything touches it, it burns it to ashes.
Yeah.
When the thunder piece parallel, you see it on the top of that wire.
Yeah.
Going then it goes inside the ground. If you go there with red oil or some flour oil, you call it, I don't know, they use in cooking.
Yeah.
Just be pouring in the hole it entered. It will be pouring, the thing will be coming out. When it comes out, you see the Shango stone.
Yeah.
So that Shango stone, if you put it on the ground and you put a stick, the stick will be making a circle on it because they have very many fake ones.
Yeah.
I can demonstrate one to you. I have some.
You mean no? You will know
that it is the authentic one.
No, but I mean if you have it now.
Have
The stick.
Uh-huh.
You have it now? Have you got it here?
Yes, I have them.
Here with you? Not. I mean in the car.
No. It's in the hotel in Orios.
Ocho Rios.
Ocho Rios.
You know, so me, I come to your hotel with your little boy.
Yes.
You could have deal me, I come to your hotel with you.
They say when a herbalist or a native doctor or a bush doctor brings out his or her oracle, he will first of all divine him for himself.
Yeah.
So when I was told I will be coming on your program, so I have to divine for your radio station.
Mm.
So that you know that it's a man that has come into your studio.
Yeah.
For instance, one, there is a woman working in this radio station that her love lock has been turned upside down. She's going to marry 3 or 4 times and still become an unmarried woman.
Wait, stick up it. The oracle is telling you that.
Huh?
The oracle is telling you that.
Yeah, not only the oracle.
I use 9 different methods of divination.
All right. So what you just say a while ago, that there's a woman working here.
Yeah.
In this radio station.
Yeah, her love luck has been turned upside down. She's going, if we marry first one, marry second, marry third, marry fourth, then she will be, still become a woman without a husband. So if she's not ashamed to come and tell you she has married once or she has this, then you don't need to say it on air. Phone me, then I will do it, neutralize it for her free of charge.
Yeah.
That's number one.
Yeah.
Then number two, in this your station, there is a young man, you will tell everybody, including yourself, to look at his wife or his girlfriend, whether he has a mark on any of the two breasts. If he has and it's not his wife, it's a girlfriend, then he knows he should go to the hospital. He should go to the hospital and do a checkup. He's already having a disease. But if he hasn't gone to bed with her, he should not go at all.
There is somebody in this.
In this radio station.
If you look on them chest, you will see a mark.
Not his chest, his girlfriend's chest.
Oh, his girlfriend's chest.
The breast.
Yes, there's a mark.
If I was working here and I have a girlfriend, I will look at her breast. If there is a scar or a mark, then it means she has a deadly disease. I shouldn't go to bed with her. Yes. If I have gone, then I have got it. May God not allow me to have a disease.
That's a serious thing.
Yeah, the third thing I'm going to tell you is, although many people love and like your station, you have two enemies. Not you as a Muta.
Yeah, but the station.
Yeah.
Yeah, the station.
The station
yeah.
has two
enemies.
One of them is wanting it to die. Because it's overshadowing them in a way. Then the other one is trying to strangle it because of certain things that come out from here to the air.
You know, all right, listen to me, stick up in. The owner, I listen to you.
Yeah.
The owner, him right now, is a youth, younger than everybody else inside us, so him, I listen. So what you just say again, that there's two
enemies
of IRFM.
Yes.
The station is called IRFM.
Okay.
You said that there are two enemies of IRFM.
Yes.
One is trying to strangle the radio station.
Because of the things coming out from here.
Yeah. And the next one.
The other one is jealous and wants to. They do voodoo. They do voodoo to make sure that it goes down.
Mm-hmm.
So what is either. Those people have a radio station or they have certain things against you. Not you at Muta.
No, I know. Uh-huh. It's a radio station.
Those are the things. You will get signs and traces of them in the near future. Then you will say, oh, this man said it that day.
So you are picking up that is our next radio station then?
You what?
You are feeling that it is our next radio station.
I'm not feeling. It is proved and ordained.
Yes.
I checked it and it's that. For instance, the book I just put there now.
Yes.
It is written there that a day to the day 9/11 will happen. I was in trance. And then it mentioned it is there.
In this book?
In that book.
Okay.
All right. Then my wife who came with me now, 7 months to the mother's death, on that same day, it was announced.
Okay. All right.
A week to the time I was coming now, a girl from Chicago, a police girl, came to initiate into the God of Olokun. When I got into trance, I told them to tell the Oba of Benin. You know, this is not something I will say in the public because the Oba is the representative of God on earth.
Yeah.
If I tell a lie, I will tell them, then it means I have killed myself.
Yes.
So I said, by tomorrow, certain things should be done. If not, blood will be flowing in the city of Benin.
Yes.
The Oba, they couldn't see him before that time. By tomorrow, somebody fought with the other son, and there was a chaos. Two people were killed on that day.
Let me ask you a question.
Yes.
I was in Nigeria in 1982.
Yeah.
Is it the same Oba that is there now? Or
it's yes, it's still the same person.
The same Oba?
Yeah, the son is...
From 1982?
Yeah. Yes.
You know, I was touched by the Oba.
You were lucky. you were lucky.
Yeah, he was telling me.
You are going to live long.
Okay.
And your fame will always be growing. Your shadow will never grow less.
Well, I hope the money grow with the fame. Yeah. I hope the money grow with the
it's
fame.
It's a rare opportunity. So yeah. Maybe when next you visit Benin, I will go with you to the palace and say, this is the Muta you touched that time.
Yeah, all right.
Yeah.
What are you doing in Jamaica?
In what?
In Jamaica. What are you doing in
Jamaica? Okay. So many things. I'm a roving herbalist. The first thing I came to do here now is one, to relax, because I have been walking by the ocean. Mm. And then I made some rituals, then pray for this kingdom, for this island, and pray for myself and my people. Then two, my wife is from St. Catherine.
Okay.
So, but I haven't gone there since I married her. So one day I hope to get there, because you do not fight with your in-law.
I noticed that you Nigerians love Jamaican women.
that could be very ego. I don't know the word to use. They love Jamaicans. I don't think Jamaicans love the Benin too.
All right. You know, when I was in Nigeria, the man, the promoter who brought me there.
I know who you are talking.
He had three, one of them had three wives, and one of them was from Jamaica.
Yes.
She was from Clarendon. And I've realized that a lot of women in Nigeria that is married to Nigerians, they come from Clarendon. Now, you are saying your wife come from St. Catherine.
Is that from Clarendon too?
No, it's a different place. But where did you meet your wife?
I was giving a lecture in Miami 16 years ago.
Mm.
You know, the eyes of a native doctor are always searching for beautiful things. So then that was how it happens.
Yes.
And since she came into my life, she has been a blessing.
Mm-hmm.
I got two keys to two cities in America already.
Mm-hmm.
And part of my largest collections on earth are in Florida. And so on and so forth.
So
yes.
What do you have in Florida? What is
the art collections. I own the biggest private collections, I would say, in Africa.
Of Bendel art.
Not only Bendel, I have Benin works, I have African works, I have works from all over the world.
No, me can't make you leave here, you know. No, me can't make him leave here, you know. No, me can't. From here, that no, my skin start itch me.
Yes.
My skin start itch me when I hear what you say a while ago, you know.
Yeah, if you go to the internet, just Google my name, Yahoo my name, or anything.
Yeah.
Or go to my website, www.boncultural.center.com. You will see a lot of works there.
Yeah.
Well, a woman that has plenty pubic hairs on her private part does not brandish them until you are paddling a beautiful canoe on the.
Yeah, I understand that. You know, yeah. You know, publicize your.
Yeah, exactly.
Your things. Yeah. All right. So when you.
Well,
I never tell nobody about nobody, man. What is this brother here as that? Nicholas, my life, you will matter. Wait, Nicholas, come back here. This is the one of the engineers that work. Yeah, engineer? This is one of the engineers that work. It's my personal brethren.
Okay.
Now, you know, you wake up the whole of Jamaica. Now.
Don't expose him. I will treat him free of charge. Your faith has already healed you. Okay, no problem.
He wants to hear something about himself.
Oh, himself.
Yeah, he wants to hear, just like when you talk about somebody.
Okay, I thought, you want to hear something about yourself?
Yeah.
Okay. Move near there. Move near the world. Say your name on the left palm.
Nicholas. Go around there.
Your left palm, say your name on it.
Say your name on your left palm.
Put it on the wall. Okay, just wait for about 3 seconds to see.
Why this should have been television?
We want to see if your live gate is opened. Okay, put it down. My son, I welcome you to the studio. Do not behave like somebody who is drunk, blind, deaf. Open your ears. If you have not buried somebody in the last few months, you are going to bury one soon, not yourself. That's number one. If you don't understand, always ask, because there is no time. Then number two, you are one of the people that we spoke about in this studio. You are going to be a rolling stone as far as marriage is concerned. Are you understanding?
You know, that's why I say rolling stone.
We'll tell you later.
Go attack, man.
Okay.
Go attack. The last
two things I will tell you is, one, don't marry a woman that is... If you are marrying a white woman, marry a white woman. If you are marrying a black woman, marry a black woman, not a woman with this color that is white or yellow. You marry a black or white. Not black that is white or black that is that is black.
Why him shouldn't do that?
Pardon?
Why him shouldn't do that?
So that he's not going to die if he marries the one they ask him not to marry, but he will always be a rolling stone. He will gather no moss. He will never prosper on earth, and he will never succeed in anything.
Okay.
Right. And I'm finally going to tell him he does not belong to this studio or to this radio station.
Where him belong?
I don't know.
My word, I fire him immediately when he said that.
You are not the one going to fire him.
No. I laugh. But you are though. Is it him?
Uh-huh.
How long are you there now? You're there longer than me?
Uh-huh.
18 years. He's here 18 years.
18.
18 years.
18.
Yes.
You see, I'm sorry to say it. He's on the wrong road. He won't say he has prospered. Tell him he's looking at you and he's looking at me. I won't say he has prospered. What are you gained by working here for 18 years? No, tell the world.
I'm not saying that because the boss listening. I can't go say that.
Tell him to tell the world what he has gained by working for IRI Radio FM since the 18 years. He has gained nothing.
All right.
Nicholas, what did he say?
All right, don't put him on the spot. Don't put Nicholas on the spot. We know why you put him on the spot.
I don't understand.
Why, Nicholas? You should come in around.
Yes, go on. Fire.
Nicholas should come in around. Nicholas, God, for the spot, though. Oh. No, that's amazing. That's amazing. All right. You know, I'm going to go back to the Yoruba.
Okay.
The Yoruba thing, because that is what I'm familiar with.
Yeah.
Now, in Cuba, they have what we call the Santeria, which is a mix-up. Just like how you have Western Christianity.
Yeah, that's all local worship.
Yeah. And in Brazil, which Brazil to me seemed to be the deepest aspect of this tradition, and as I said, the way you dress is how I see these people. I don't know if you can explain to me, why is it that the Brazilian tradition is much deeper in this tradition than say Cuba, even though we know of Cuba as a deep, you know, Cuba have the all I do, man, the Shango, the all of the different gods, like what you just mentioned. But
yeah, the first thing I will tell you is that most of these practitioners of this religion in the West, and those that come from certain parts of Africa, including my own part, some of them are fakes.
Yeah,
and when they come here and do anything, they put people into problem. So many. Because initiation or giving an orisha or a god or a deity to somebody is very dangerous. You can give it to a person, then you have killed him forever. The man's life could be shortened, his progress eroded. He can even become a second-dated human being. He won't be able to make love to women and so on and so forth.
All right, stick up in here. This is the Coaching Age and IRFM. So we get so embroiled in this conversation that we forget to do certain things here. It's really 15 minutes past 12 where we should do this at 12. I know Nicholas says same corner, but Nicholas, I have good news for you. Chad just come in at the studio. You see, Franz? Chad just come talk to me a while ago. You see, we should have webcast it. That's the world can't see this man. Yeah, you know what I mean? Yeah, that's why we love Chad. So, you know, yeah, you know. Anyway, we're talking to the chief here, Abohun, and he's from Benin, Bendel State. I almost mix up Benin, the country, with Benin in Nigeria.
Yes.
Because it's two different places.
Mm-hmm.
All right. You were talking about your Florida connection, and you meet your wife there, and you know the artifacts that you have and thing.
Yeah.
I was saying what you're doing here. So
yes.
you come not only to have a nice time on the beach, but also to visit your wife.
Yeah.
Place.
The truth is that wherever I go, mm-hmm. before I get there, my clients all over the world will phone certain people that he's coming there. Then they'll be calling in mm-hmm. to my local number.
Okay.
And although I'm holidaying, mm-hmm. People are registering their problems, and then I'm not going to be able to consult with them because I'm flying to Africa on emergency on the 14th.
14th of May.
Pardon?
14th of May.
Yeah, I didn't understand.
14th of this month?
Yes, 14th of May.
So you will be here until the 14th?
No. I'm leaving in 2 days' time or 3 days' time.
I was going to invite you up to my house, man.
Yeah, so let me continue. There are two people.
Yeah.
One is having a terrible court case. I'm going to neutralize it. I just did one in Washington, D.C. about a week and a half ago. The mother was crying. The lawyer was saying, what happened? Then I said, until a child knows what kills the father in the king's palace, he never fears the king. I said, don't worry. What happened, you will know in the future.
Yeah.
So it was they who bought me a ticket to go and work for one of their people.
Mm-hmm.
So that is just by the way. Let me quickly give three things to the listening audience. One, it is dangerous to sit under a big tree in the night.
Mm.
A big tree, not a small tree, a big tree that had already taken a title and witches perch on it in the night. Because mm-hmm. when they are eating, the droplets can cause epilepsy, can cause leprosy, can cause HIV. Not only when you make a love to a woman that you get HIV. So that is number one. Then number two, it is dangerous to drive the center of the road as from 12:01 a.m.
Why is that?
The reason is the road you drive on in the afternoon could become big malls, could become a river. So that if you drive on it, then you say, you come and see a trailer on the side of the road. They will say the driver was sleeping. The driver wasn't sleeping.
Mm.
He saw what he shouldn't have seen. Mm. There are many things around us that are incapable of explanation, according to Kamara Laye. Then the third one is, you who love music, it's dangerous once it's 12:01 to put on your music and let people outside be hearing it, because not all people, not human beings, like we are in the studio now, there are three other people with us.
Mm-hmm.
So they may not like what we are doing, but we don't know.
Mm-hmm.
Those who know will say, oh, don't do that. So when you are playing music in the night, there are some people reading in their offices right on the roadside, because it's not what it is in the afternoon, it is in the night.
Yeah.
So it's better you don't play at all. You don't play music when I'm with you in the car in the night. Even in the day, I don't even like it.
All right. So make I ask you a question?
Yeah.
All right. Two questions. One, is this what you're explaining and the other thing? Is this a gift or is it learned? Did you learn this or is it a gift?
I understand. I think they are both. Because I was born in a Christian home 72 years ago.
Mm-hmm.
And my father...
Oh, you're 72?
Yes, I'm 72.
All right, sir.
Yes.
Yeah.
So then my father's name is on the wall of a Baptist church. Mm-hmm. In 1972, I told him I will not attend church again.
Mm-hmm.
It took them many years to persuade me I didn't go back.
Mm.
Because when I'm sitting, when I'm standing, I'll be getting messages.
Mm-hmm.
In 1976 or so, when Muritala was killed. I'm talking the whole world will hear. If I'm lying, they will say I'm lying.
The whole world is here.
I will quote two names, although one of them is dead, one is still alive. In the blood, I saw a king being slaughtered. A king. So I called a press conference and told them that either a king or a head of state was going to be killed.
When that?
That was seven. I think you, the airport you came down in Lagos is named after the head of state, okay. Muritala Mohammed.
Yeah.
So this was on a Thursday, Friday, no, Wednesday. On Friday, he was killed. He was driving alone into the mosque.
Mm-hmm.
But they were afraid to write it until after he was killed.
Okay.
But I told them that the television had been shut off. Then, some years ago, during Babangida's reign, I was sitting like this. Then a plane fell. It carried a lot of Nigerian soldiers within the class.
I remember that.
Crash. Okay, about 30-something of them.
Yeah.
So I called a press conference. I said, a plane is going to fall within a few days, carrying soldiers. The day it will fall, the head of state should not wear black. The wife should not wear black. They should, when they are going to see the corpses, which they did. The plane fell 4 o'clock that day. So television, radio didn't carry it again because it was a few minutes to when they should carry it because they were afraid. But a newspaper had gone to bed. Nigerian Observer, that one couldn't retract them. So they now came to be saying, how did you know? I say, well, it's passed. Mm-hmm. So many things like that. So when a fowl gets to a new town or a new place, he will raise up one leg. He will say, I don't know if they stand on one leg in this place.
Yeah.
So a time will come when I come again, I will predict for Jamaica because
yeah.
there are a few problems here.
All right, so let me ask you the next question now.
Yeah.
This question is, this what you talk about, these powers that you speak of, I am assuming that they have been with the Benin people for hundreds of years. This gift and learned thing.
Yes.
All right.
In fact, I didn't answer your question. The second one is I learned it because my mother had birth problems. She had 12 children from my father. Only myself lived. Then she had one elsewhere. We are two. The other one is senior to me by 12 or 14 years.
Okay.
So because of that, she started going from one native
doctor. Alive? Is that still alive?
Who?
The other son.
Yes, he's 80-something. My mother is alive.
Yeah, okay.
She's 112.
She's 112.
Every day she tells me, you won't come and meet me. Come home in time. When I get there, she's there.
Okay.
I even prepared her grave. I had to cover it and say, so that she can die. She won't die. So that is that. So she has to be going from native doctor to native doctor. 3/4 of what I know in herbs are taught to me by my mother. Then the rest by others. But the mystical aspect are a gift. Because when somebody is coming to my center, I don't need to bring out an oracle. I will say this is
like what you talk about, the station here. That's a gift.
Yes. Yeah. So what I'm going to tell you is one day, you will arrange your microphones in such a way I will be going in the midst. I put myself into trance. Then tell people to phone in. Yeah. Then I will say, oh, you phone in, you have this problem. But I will bring an interpreter because the gods don't speak in English. Although they hear all languages, I don't hear all languages.
So if I should open the phone now and let people call, and they ask you, just like this brethren, this person that came in the studio a while ago, you could tell them,
I will,
what can befall them.
I will. But the better one is if I'm in trance. If I put myself to trance now, it will be a little. All I need to do is, I will say, give me any music there. Within 3 to 16 minutes or less, I'm in trance.
Yes.
Then I can tell you anything and
so you can go anywhere to authentic. How do I get you come out of the trance?
When I come out,
would you come out of the trance?
You know the honey bee, is never drunk. When you go into the spirit world,
yeah,
you come back.
You're full of proverbs, but I love that.
I'm a high priest. I come back.
Yes.
But the thing is, if the gods want to really use me, I could be in trance for hours. All you need to do is to close your station, then the gods will be working, then you will be recording.
Well, maybe we'll just take up the trance thing a little more. But we can ask the next question I was going to ask is this. With all of these powers that you propose to have and your ancestors propose to have, how is it that the Europeans could have gone to Africa and devastated Africa so much that now we are here? What did not happen in Africa?
Yeah.
With all these powers that you manifest and profess to have, how is it that the Europeans overcome these powers and brought us here?
The Europeans overpowered maybe the powers of certain ones of those days. They can't overpower my own. I've just produced a film on the sack of Benin. They can't overpower my own.
It's not in here. It's not on the CD.
It's DVD. In English. It's a DVD.
No, I know. It's the thing that he produces on this DVD. Eh?
Yeah.
All right.
So
all right.
What I'm trying to say is there was still apartheid in South Africa.
Mm.
I had the statue of a slave in chains in my center. Mm. Then Obasanjo, who was the military president then, said we should go and dismantle apartheid in South Africa with African black power.
Yeah, but I'm talking about now this coast, this West Coast, Nigeria, Ghana, Senegal serve as a export for Africans. But you are proposing that we Africans have all of these powers, but was not used to keep back.
Have power in Africa are not ostentatious, they are not loud, and they are very secretive. For instance, an African witch, there are 9 categories of witchcraft. The first 4 are very good. They are the worst witch is better than the best human being. You know a witch.
Yeah, man.
Everywhere on earth, they brand them to be bad. The worst amongst them is better than the best human being on earth.
Mm.
So that is just by the way. They cannot say because you have... How many times do you pray in a year for God to make you the president of America, of Jamaica? Has the prayer come true? I'm just using it for example.
Yeah, yeah.
Everybody prays every day to win lotto or to win lottery. Have they won?
No.
Does it mean God is asleep? He's not sleeping.
Mm.
Everything is sifted and honored according to their importance. So that maybe something is happening in one African country, then you will say, where are all the people that have powers there? For instance, you go to you are passing a courthouse, then you just hear that somebody is in the dock. You get there, then you just start talking, say, I will bear witness for this matter. They will say, what is your own in this matter? Face the wall. You are sentenced to 3 months imprisonment. What is your own is not good in any case. What I'm trying to say is, the people who have power in Africa, they are not on judgment throne to say, let me go and neutralize this, except individuals will see that something is going to happen somewhere, then he neutralizes it. So, but it's not everything, because there are some that are of natural accord.
No, but wait there, you are telling me this, that Africans is watching these invaders coming into Africa to take Africans out of Africa and put them on boats and ships.
Okay.
And other Africans is sitting there having power and is keeping that power to themselves.
Okay.
And not recognizing that there is a need to rescue their brethren.
It's now I understand what you are saying.
Mm.
The truth is that when Africans were being carried away as slaves, there was greed, lust for money, and the beautiful things they were bringing from overseas or from the colonial countries.
Mm.
Remember that those who sold slaves are like politicians of today. They are greedy. They may use charm to neutralize him. Then he starts confessing and at the pain of death. So, and I said things of natural accord, unless they happen, things are never normalized on earth. If we were not sold as slaves to certain parts of the world, Africa would be darkness forever. Today, the world is ruled by a black man, whether you like it or not.
All right, we'll seek opinion or no, because this is which part, no, me gone. As I have heard, mainly ACF people suggest that if Africans was left in Africa, we would be in darkness. And I know that before slavery, we were not in darkness. We were living according to how we were living.
Yeah.
Europeans come there and put us in darkness. Now, as an African, as a chief coming from Africa, you are saying to me that if white people never come to Africa and take us out, we would be in darkness in Africa.
For a long time. I can prove that to you.
So we are in the light now.
In Africa?
No. Anywhere we are. We are in light now.
Yeah, we are in the light. What brought the light?
So we are better off here than being before slavery.
A culture cannot improve or develop without any intercourse with other cultures.
Yeah, we understand that. But the intercourse that we have wasn't like the Chinese going to India or the Russians going to South Africa. Yeah. It is slavery. Slavery is slavery. It is not the same thing.
You have brought me to a very crucial matter.
Yes.
All over the world, both the blacks and the whites believe that only the blacks were sold as slaves.
No, we're not talking about other slavery now. We're talking about what you said.
Yes.
You said
it's a thing of natural accord. Something written down by your destiny and by your nature that must happen so that certain things... It's action and counter actions.
Yeah, but what is the action? No, listen.
Okay.
I am talking about what you say, you know.
Yeah.
We're talking about the darkness as opposed to the light.
Yeah.
Now, you are saying, no, black people, in other words, black people is better off amongst these white people here in the West here than how we were before they came there.
No. Maybe I misinterpreted myself.
What I'm trying to explain
is that if we had not left home to see what is happening outside.
Yeah.
In fact, the black is dominating the world today, whether you like it or not.
Not dominating the world, man. It's Chinese dominating the world because we still...
Obama is president, I'm saying it.
No, we're not talking about
Obama. Any country you go, it is the black man's intelligence that is being feared. Anywhere.
All right.
In many aspects.
I want to go back to the darkness and the light.
The darkness I said was this.
Yeah. What is the darkness that black people was in before white people got to Africa?
The darkness is that with up till tomorrow, what I'm trying to explain is that even there are still some people in Africa that do not know that there is another country outside Africa or outside of
Asia. They in Europe that don't know.
They don't know it too, but who had not gone to Africa, the knowledge they have now, they wouldn't have had it.
Yeah, but...
It's a marriage of culture.
I'm not against the marriage of cultures. You know? I'm not against we knowing what they...
I think it was Mary McLeod. I can't remember.
No, wait. Stick up in brethren, because we're not coming out for this.
Yes.
We're talking about darkness and light.
Yes.
And you say that if black people did stay in Africa, they would be in a darkness.
Those there now?
No. Oh. If white people never go to Africa,
we
would be in darkness. That is what you say.
I said that.
Yes.
But what I'm trying to explain to you is that there are certain things that happen to you that make you develop, that make you...
So you're saying that if we never come here, we wouldn't develop?
We will develop. It's not Jamaica alone you came in. It's not America alone. You came. We went to other parts of the world. Even till tomorrow, the number of Africans coming to Europe and the number of Europeans or Americans going to Africa are still surging. What I'm trying to say is, God or nature arranged it.
No man, no disrespect to the way the man has said. No, okay, disrespect. Okay. No disrespect to the chief.
Yeah.
But you see them reasoning there now. We don't like entertain them reasoning there, you know, because here we know.
Yeah.
We know the history of Africa.
Yes.
Before white people got here.
Yes.
And we know say Africa was not in no darkness before white people. It's not white people bring light to Africa.
No, no, no. It's not the white man. It's not the white man that brought light to Africa.
No, but you are claiming that.
Yeah.
In leaving Africa.
Yeah.
We're in the light. And black people, if we didn't see Africa, would have in the dark.
Well,
what is the darkness that you speak of? We're not talking about connection now, because black people has always been, the Moors and all these people was always going into Europe. It is the Moors that gave Europe a lot of the civilization that they have. It's black people do that.
You
so
are
I'm
right.
Saying, and so I'm saying now, what is the darkness?
What I mean, maybe
that black people was
maybe
in
because,
before white people got here. Maybe what is because, the darkness?
Maybe because of the way I said it, or the way...
Well, you have to say it better, you know, brethren. You have to say it better.
Let me, let me say
it. You have to go up on the wrong side.
Muta, let me say it this way. Let me say it this way.
Say it better, yeah.
Okay. What I meant is that, you see, culture cannot develop without mixing with other cultures.
But we was mixing with other cultures for thousands of years.
Okay.
That is how the Greeks treat each.
Most of the things that happen in America today, the development in Africa, in America, are done by blacks. You know that?
Yeah.
They are done by blacks.
Yes.
And that is a credit to you and your people at home.
So it's because we come here, why we could have did do that? Or we did have that in a way before the white people come
Let
here?
Let us face reality. It's not the white man that taught them here.
No,
when
I am
they
saying
came here,
you,
it's
I
not
am,
the white man that
no, no,
taught
I am
them.
Saying, I am saying, the darkness that you say was in Africa.
Well, that is maybe
the darkness
a mis-
was in Africa.
It's a misquote. What I'm trying
no,
to say.
No, I'm mis- who are misquote? You
I've corrected. I've corrected it. Now, what I'm
well,
trying
to. Well, better correct it quick, you know.
I've corrected that, but what
correct
I'm saying
quick.
Is, let us face reality.
Yeah, me face reality.
A
man.
Black man developed this bulb, electric bulb, in America.
So what? All right. Suppose we never developed the bulb in Africa. That means that we was in darkness.
Let me tell you one thing. In America today, there are two African boys. One developed a car that uses water to run. America killed it. He needed small money. I told them in Africa, send money to this boy. He's a professor at University of Tennessee. They didn't send because maybe it's not from their family or things like that. One day, it will come up. If it's in Africa,
no.
Let's face reality.
No, it's me not face that. No, here one. No, me face reality long time. You know.
Okay.
Here my reality. No, my reality is this.
Yes.
That African people was in Africa.
Yes.
Doing what them doing. You, certain set of mind. A mind is deciding that it is because black people come here. Why we are in light, why we know what we know and understand what we understand.
No, but no, no. That's
I am saying to you that there's a lot of things that we did not know in Africa, that because we come here, we know. But I refuse to accept this, I don't know what I call it, stupidity and ignorance, that black people was in the dark.
No, no, no. They
in Africa. Yeah. And it's white people come there and show the light. Because black people existed.
They can't show us light.
Thousands of years. Yeah, but if we're not the dark and we come here, so we're not the light.
Maybe it's a misquote or a misunderstanding. What
yeah,
I'm really Virginia, trying
you have
to...
You have to choose your words when you talk to me.
What I'm trying to say, is this.
Yeah.
There are natural atmospheres
but
conducive for people...
Slavery
like you are in the studio
song.
Now.
Slavery
if I take you out
song.
Under a tree, you cannot perform as you are performing in the studio.
Yeah, but
what I'm trying to say
thing.
Is,
slavery not a natural thing.
We came to civilize the white man in many aspects.
Civilize this white man
in many aspects, and we are still doing it. They troop there every day to take knowledge.
White people.
What I'm saying is
what? What you mean civilized? We can't civilize somebody. Them have them civilization already.
Well, I'm a bush doctor and a native doctor. My English, you should always
interpret. Understand your English, man. Me understand your English clearly. It's you don't understand my English.
Okay.
Yeah.
And maybe I don't understand your own. Yeah. What I'm trying to say really is what the black man had done in all parts of the world.
Yes.
After leaving home, develop those countries. The underworld productions.
Yeah, but I don't say no to that. You I don't say no. No, I don't say, I'm not disputing that.
Yes.
I know that the contribution of black people to the Western civilization
is enormous.
You can see it. But to say that white people, the absence of white people in Africa.
No.
Means we would be in darkness.
That is not my inference.
Man, you have to go sleep on that and do some things to rectify that.
What Muta is misinterpreting is that I said my people living home gave them the opportunity to do what they are doing there. In fact, let's face reality. If we were at home, we won't be able to. You think it is now that our people are going home, that we are having conducive atmospheres for manufacture of certain things.
If we never connect to European civilization, we'll be living longer. Because most indigenous people live long. And yes. It's when them start to associate with the Western mindset that you see them all sorts of things that we never know about. Take all of it.
I agree with you.
Yes. So that I is agree what with you
because
living longer would be better
because
for us in that civilization.
Food, medicine, and everything we are taking from them are shortening our lives.
Yes. So what I agree. That is darkness. That is darkness. That is not light.
Yes, it is.
The light we have, and most indigenous cultures have.
Yes.
The Western world has wiped out that.
I feel.
And has caused the people them.
I feel. Yeah, we will progress.
You have to give me something for my blood pressure, you know.
Yes.
Because you raise my blood pressure, man.
So let's remove the black.
You have to give me something for my blood pressure, Rasta.
No problem.
What is good for blood pressure? Tell me. You know the African tradition, you know, because the Western thing now work.
You said what is there?
What is good for blood pressure? Because in this society, this Western society,
we are
prone to the rising of our pressure because of talk like what you just talked.
Okay. So the blood pressure will leave. I withdrew the darkness and the blood pressure will go. Blood pressure is caused by many things.
Yes.
One.
Like one, Africans come tell you, say, we would be in the darkness if white people.
No, we will never.
Blood pressure. Blood pressure. So
Tell
me something to heal the blood pressure. Don't tell me what caused it.
Okay.
What caused it. Tell me what. To destabilize it and get rid of it.
Okay.
Yes.
In Jamaica, there are some leaves.
Yes.
If you eat them 3 times a day for a certain number of days, blood pressure is gone.
Tell me the leaf them. Are you not familiar?
I don't know the name, but I can show it to you. In Africa,
it's in this book?
Huh?
It's in this book? The same leaf.
If I write it there, I won't eat again, Muta. So if I write it there, I won't eat again. How would you come to me?
No, but then I only for artifacts where you can't sell, man. Be yourself, man. You're only for artifacts.
If you want to come to school, you come. I train you. You pay me. Then when you graduate,
I use brethren, not friends. Know that me, I use developing a relationship.
That's true. Honestly speaking, high blood pressure is caused by bad foods and so many things. Then the worst one of it is those caused by bad people, voodoo and things like that. But they can all be treated. And the first treatment is you must tell yourself that you will obey the laws of nature. You must rest. You must not over-exercise yourselves with women and things like that. Then number two, there are certain foods that relaxes your blood pressure. Then there are certain animals. I don't know if you have heard of snail.
Yeah, man.
The water from snail is one of the best curatives for high blood pressure. Then there are some leaves, vegetables. which you eat, and then they maybe if I think I have a few in Mobe medication for blood pressure and diabetes.
All right, so you have a office where you accept patients
in Mobe.
No, in wherever you live. In
I have Arizona. A herbal hospital in Nigeria. Then I have a...
You have a hospital in Nigeria?
Yeah.
I mean, like a herb hospital.
A herbal hospital.
You don't deal with...
not with modern medicine.
Medical, it's modern herb, medicine.
It's herbs.
Just pure herbs.
Yes. Then in U.S., I have some Americans who studied under me, not black Americans, where they initiated and they are healing. So I prepare medications for them and they use them to treat their patients.
In Florida?
In U.S.
We're in U.S., in Florida?
One is in Oakland, California, Nedra Williams.
You're serious? I come out of Oakland all the while, you know?
Her address is in that book, too. Yes.
Oh, I forgot to tell my friend, must check your man. I have some brethren where would come and talk to you. That's in Oakland.
Okay.
Yeah, they have vegetarian restaurant in Oakland.
Okay.
Yeah.
Then in Miami, I have a herbal hospital in the air.
What do you mean?
That means the permanent place is not ready.
Okay.
So, although the medications are in our house, but I move here and there to treat their patients.
So where are these artifacts that you speak of? Where are the artifacts?
About 300 and something pieces were loaned to Broward County Library 12 years ago. They are preparing to return them to Africa now.
Because
I want them to return them. Then we have some in our house for emergency exhibitions.
Okay.
Like some people wants to do like... what do they call those police in America? They were doing 30 years or 25 years or 50 years. They came to loan some of them.
Mm-hmm.
Then in my website, you will see quite a lot in there. One thing is, I don't sell the antiquities.
Yes.
Although I've never sold one yet.
Yeah.
But I think by the time we open the center, there will be a craft shop. Where because we want them like other tribes to be penetrating the world. Yes.
Okay.
Yeah.
This is the Cutting Edge and IRFM. We're talking to the Chief Ebohun here and things, you know. We see you have a CD, a DVD here. It's about a theater troupe. What is this theater troupe? The theater troupe.
Yes, Ebohun International Theater Troupe.
Yeah.
What happened is the way the white man dealt with my kingdom was what made me leave Christianity, and then I started traditional worship. That DVD is on the sack of Great Benin by Britain and the deportation of our Oba in 1897.
Mm.
In fact, the Oba of the kingdom gave me beads. Immediately it came out some months ago. It took me 14 years to work on, and I came to Negril, Jamaica to take sunset. Negril, Jamaica is there as one of the locations.
Oh, so this is not your first visit here?
My third or fourth visit.
Oh, this is the third or fourth
visit? In 1977, I was here as a government artist. I led 61 artists to come and thank Jamaica for participating in the first act. The minister, Chief Enahoro came, Dr. Asiwaju came, and some other officials of the National Theater, but I was the head of the artists.
All right, explain to me your regalias that you have. Explain to me.
Well, this is, I'm dressing like a traditional Bini and a high priest.
Yes.
The red on top is to show you that I'm a high priest, and this is to Aramila, this is to Ogun Olokun, and this is to Ogun, the god of iron. Whereas these are for chieftaincy and being a Benin man that had been
honored. So what kind of bead is that?
Are the real coral beads.
Okay.
It's not the fake one. So if you look at them, the whole I'm putting on the body now, if you put it on scale, it will weigh more than almost 50 pounds. It will be more than 50 pounds. Yeah. They are very heavy.
Yeah, those beads.
Yeah.
All right, and the same beads on your hand is the same beads.
Yeah, the round one.
Yes.
Can only be worn with the permission of the Oba of Benin.
Okay.
You cannot. It's forbidden. And as it's on my neck, I cannot put anything in my mouth. If I want to, I must remove them.
Oh, yeah?
Yes, it's forbidden.
Why is that?
It's forbidden.
Well, tell me why.
The ancestors will be annoyed. It's a disrespect and dishonor to them.
Mm-hmm.
Mm. He said, those who know the king never fell Iroko tree.
Okay.
Mm.
Okay, that's very interesting. And that...
this one,
that's ivory.
The government of America issued a paper on it to say that I did not violate the American law by bringing it to the country. It's part of my regalia.
Yeah.
So I've been traveling with it to America since 1977. But 3 years ago, some young immigration or custom boys were very agile and enthusiastic, and then they took it. They said it's ivory. So I told them that they will return it.
Mm.
So after 1 month, they wrote me a letter. I had the letter in the hotel in Mobe that it was detained at Detroit Airport.
Mm.
But after going through it, they found that I did not violate the American law or the law of America, it had been returned. I should sign. I signed. So it's one of the paraphernalias of my office.
Right. Explain to me why. All right, going back again to Yoruba, because I am kind of getting this feeling that you are very nationalistic when it comes to Benin.
Mm.
Like, everything, I am figuring that everything is centered to you in Benin and Bendel State in terms of the traditions of life and the gods and everything. But there is a feeling that the Africans, including the Nigerians, who find themselves in Nigeria, came from Northeast Africa, which is like in
Egypt,
Kemet, Ethiopia, and these places. I realize that you don't give credence to that. You don't accept that.
I will not, because for instance, the Yoruba culture germinates from Benin, but because they went to school before us, they were trying to pervert history. The Oba of Benin wrote a book, Yours Faithfully, I Am Yours Faithfully, where he explained the Benin-Ife relationship, which you will find in that book too.
Yes.
What happens is that the last of the Ogisos, kings of Benin, before the Obaship started, was banished for ordering the execution of a pregnant woman. But before then, he asked that his son should be executed on the basis that the chiefs and his wife said it was the boy that made him not to have more children. But fortunately for the boy, they did not kill him. They asked him because they were not sure he would have any other child.
Yeah.
So it was he that founded Ife. And if you go there, Ife is a Benin word, Ilefe, Ilefe, I have escaped to safety, is in that book. And the first son, I chose the road to posterity, everything is there. So when in 1971, Professor Biobaku, a very top Yoruba scholar, Abiola Irele were asked to defend certain clauses in Olarotimi's book of Onram Enogbaisi, they could not. And I told them, if I ask you 19 questions on the areas you are authority and you are able to answer two or three, I will allow the phrases to go. They were not. And so they were expunged from the pool. Because I know you are looking at time. That's why I'm also...
No, that time I'm looking at is okay. Advertisement.
Yeah.
No, so you believe that life started in Benin?
Definitely. Even in Benin, we say Edo is Yagmo. Benin is the origin of the world. What happens is that anywhere you go on earth, you must find one thing or another in Benin that is there. For instance, in Japan, half of their vocabulary are Benin language. In Japan. Japan, Tokyo is Edo. The meaning of Japan is Edo, which is the language we speak, and so on and so forth. If you go to Boston, Massachusetts in America, you will find Ivie, you will find Ogbewi, you will find Erie. They are Benin words. And then the soil in Benin, the red Ulapa, the red soil in Benin, only China has something that is very near resemblance, but it's not as authentic as that of Benin, because the one of Benin is gummy. That is what we use in preparing the bronze work. Ulapa no geken. Ulapa, the king of soil. Yes.
All right. I have been among some what I'm calling Native Americans in Phoenix, Arizona, in Arizona.
Yeah.
Named the Hopi Indian. I don't know if you ever hear of them. This is a group, very, very passive kind of people, very spiritual.
Yeah.
They carry me to a stone. And this stone is said that if this stone move the earth, that's it. They believe that at certain points in their, where Arizona, that is where the earth started. That is where people started. Oh, you see that? I mean, I know you don't accept that, but what I'm trying to say is that it would appear to me that in every tradition, people get so close up with their section of earth that they believe that
this their own life, their own
yet
is
still,
best.
Yet still, there is no archaeological evidence to prove that this is where it started.
There are.
All right. Yeah.
For instance, let me tell you, there are many laws in nature. For instance, you know the rooster or the cock. The cock.
Yes.
Kakaraka, until it kills a snake, it does not crow. It's a law of nature. Until an eagle kills a tortoise or a turtle, it cannot
grow. That include worm?
Huh?
That include worm?
Eagle.
No, the cock.
No, not worm, snake.
But there's no snake in Jamaica.
And then?
And cock crow.
There are snakes in Jamaica.
No, there's no snake.
Look.
That,
I won't argue with you yet.
I'm not going to argue with you about the cock in a Nigeria right now. But
I won't argue with you.
Cocks crow in Jamaica and them don't eat snakes.
You will be shocked that you have snakes in Jamaica.
No, listen. I'm not saying that snake not in Jamaica. I'm saying that cocks crow in Jamaica that has never seen snake.
You are that's true. You are exaggerating some scientific assumptions.
No, you are
that snakes are not in Jamaica. You will be shocked.
No, you are, no. I'm not saying
the that's, next no, time I will come. No, no, the no. next time I will come, I will take you out.
No, I never said
you
snake.
You take a tape recorder. Then I will call a snake from your bush. If it comes, it means I brought it from Africa.
Look here, I'm not saying that. I have seen snake in Jamaica.
You have not seen it. Even few days before I came now.
Nah, man, listen to my brethren.
Few days before I came from U.S. now, I was going on foot because every morning I trek 3 miles. I saw a lizard cut off the head of a small snake. But so I quickly called fire brigade.
Yeah, hear me now?
I called fire brigade. Yeah. I called the owner of the house. I said, look. So he said he didn't know there are snakes around his house.
But I am telling you that I know such snake is in Jamaica.
Yeah.
I have seen I know people who keep snake.
Oh. Okay.
And feed them with rat.
Yes.
And feed them with egg.
But you've never seen a snake?
Yes. Okay. I have seen a snake.
Okay.
I have seen snake all the while in Jamaica.
Okay.
What I am saying to you, that cocks
crow here.
Crow here without eating snake.
You are right. Let me tell you one thing. There are two differences between the cock that crows after killing a snake and a cock that crows what we call artificial crowing. Do you know cocks that are bred inside their cages? they crow. You know that?
But I talk about cock.
The one that kiss a snake will tell you when you are entering the road, don't go, there is danger.
No, I don't say no to that, you know. I just say, to make this broad statement that cocks crow only when they eat snake.
Is I agree with you, but I'm telling you that there are two categories of the cock that is in the cage crows without killing a cock. The cock in Jamaica, not without killing a snail. A snake, I mean. Snake. The one in Jamaica crows without killing a snake because you haven't seen a snake here. But if
this snake here, but them don't kill the snake for eat for crow.
Oh, you saw snakes, but the cocks don't kill them.
No.
Okay, right.
Let me go slow.
Okay.
There's a language thing happening here.
Okay.
In Jamaica.
Yeah.
There are many snakes in Jamaica.
Snakes?
Yes.
Okay.
There are snakes in Jamaica.
Okay.
I am coming off what you said. You said that cocks crow because they eat snakes. And I am saying to you that in Jamaica, cocks crow
without killing snakes.
But no, you are now rebutting it now and saying no, the cocks that crow is false crowing.
And we also hold you to that because a cock will not say, Mr. Muta, come and say I want to kill a snake so that I can crow.
No,
they don't do that. They kill them.
But you still admit, you still insist that the cock them in Jamaica eat snakes.
A cock in your compound can kill a snake without your seeing it.
Brethren.
Very authentic.
No, tell me about the cock in Nigeria. Don't tell me about the Jamaican cock.
Well, I agree with you.
Jamaican cock with all bark.
The ones in Nigeria, when they are killing snakes, they don't call the landlord. They don't call the king and say, come, I want to kill a snake so that I can crow.
Yes.
It is natural to them that they kill a snake.
To crow,
when they could be killing it under your bed without your seeing it. Yes. So that is it. They kill them in the bush. We don't nomad with the cocks when they are going inside the bushes nomadically and the snake a snake can kill it. We won't know, except if the one that kills his own is coming with you dragging it like then you say this one has killed the snake. Maybe one day you will see it so that they can prove me right.
But you still in a insist that Jamaican cock crow. It's because them eat snake, and I tell you, say no go so.
I agree with you, but what I'm saying is, the cock cannot invite you from the studio to come and see it killing it.
I know that.
Okay, that's okay. Then number two, I told you there are cocks or roosters in cages. In cages,
so they have a false crowing.
That's
what you said.
But the ones that have the authentic natural,
the ones who kill the snake,
they tell you when they crow at certain times, they tell you what is going to happen.
All right,
and then they say go and kill that cock. It's like when you see a dog dig a ground and put his head into it.
Yeah.
In Jamaica, you say it doesn't mean anything. It's not your fault because time has changed certain things. But when the repercussion comes, they don't know it is because of that.
All right, tell me why the dog. Can my dog do it otherwise? Or tell me why the
When he does it all the time, he doesn't do it when something is not going to happen.
Mm.
When he digs a hole and puts his head inside, it means somebody is going to die.
Yes.
But you can prevent that accidental death if you kill the dog. If you kill it. I have a neighbor in a place. I don't want to mention the place. They are Cubans.
Yeah.
The wife was kissing a dog. I said, "Did you inject this of rabies?" And he's a medical doctor. Then she said, "Yes, we have done it." Mm. So right, many
can
things.
Can I ask you a question?
Uh-huh.
Have you ever known a case where a person, the dog, digging the hole? And a person dead?
Have I ever?
You know of cases
that
the dog digging the hole simply shows you that somebody's going to dead. So the person dead.
I've seen a lot.
All right. Have you ever seen a case where you kill the dog and somebody's still dead?
You could be right, but I have never seen one.
You never seen that yet?
Because I know when they do it, there will be a sign that something like this wanted to happen.
Yeah.
But it didn't happen again. But where they killed the dog and the man still dies, it could be possible, but I will be Mr. Know-All if I say I saw it.
Yes.
It's the good ones I will see.
Yeah. Uh-huh. Yeah. So that is from the Benin tradition.
Not Benin tradition, that is African tradition.
It's an African tradition that if a dog keeps digging a hole and laying down in the hole.
In the what?
In the hole.
Wood?
Hole. In the hole. He digs out a dirt. And
yes, yes. It. And put his head inside.
Yes. That means somebody
is going to... It's bad omen. It's not good.
And if you kill the dog, it means the omen pass.
Yes. Something bad is going to happen in that house.
Yes.
Or in that family. So they quickly kill it.
Yeah. All right. I have seen... Well... You know, I don't know nobody where from I sit dog, I do this thing.
Yes.
Maybe them dead far away. But I don't know if nobody were dead my life. Because I never kill the dog. Because I personally know, anybody were dead around me is something... That is happening to them, but I don't. I am very conscious.
It's not the dog.
No. Listen, I am very conscious.
Yeah.
That dogs know things. For instance, earthquake.
Yeah.
I know that dogs have an ear for things that human beings don't have, and a perception.
Yeah.
So I am not crossing off what you're saying. You know. I am not crossing off what you're saying. You know.
Let me quickly chip in this one.
Yeah.
I don't know if Jamaican dogs do it. If you want to test food, if it has been poisoned,
give the dog.
Give dog.
And if the dog. Okay,
but these Alsatian dogs, they eat it and die.
You know what the Europeans used to do? The Europeans used to give them servant it. If the servant dead,
even some eat it. Some young thieves in my country will poison chicken and give to a big man's dog. He will eat it and die of the poison and take his car away. But the traditional dogs, they won't eat. The same thing with lizards. I don't know the lizards. If you throw food on the ground and it doesn't eat, it means the food is bad.
All right. In Jamaica, they say that if a goat eat a plant, it never grow. Yeah, it never grow again.
Mm-hmm.
And I proved that is not true.
You see?
You know what I prove? Mm-hmm. I prove that the reason why the goat... When the goat eat the thing, it don't grow again because the goat eat it to the point where we root it out. Because I know plants, I see plants where goat eat continuously, and every time I go back there,
yes,
the plant flourish. So when I look and the plant them that don't grow back is the one where the goat eat and shake him head. So every time him hold the leaf, him shake him head and root out the plant.
Yeah.
So them say the plant I eat. So those little things is observations that I am feeling that a lot of people give it over to some nature of superstition, but it have some relationship with something that can be explained. Now, I not giving over what you say about the dog.
Yes.
I know that it's not the dog causing the death. But I know, dogs have a perception and dog have an ear that is beyond human being. So I wouldn't, you know, a dog.
Agreeing the dog's intelligence, but why the average African believes in his intelligence? That is why they know that if he sees poison, he will be able to why? Yeah. Although we have ones that are superior to the dogs, or you cut it on your finger. If you are going to carry the food, it will be you put ant in the medic in the herb in the voodoo. You use herb to grind it, ant to grab it. So if you are taking it there and it stinks you, then you know there is poison in the food.
Yes.
We have the one for dictating sexual diseases. You cut it seven around the waist when you are. Then you are unable
to... The Chinese have chopstick that they take poison in food.
Uh-huh.
You know, chopsticks that they eat with. They have certain chopsticks that they make that when you put it in the food...
They will know it is poison.
It detect poison. Okay. All right. In Benin, how you view polygamy?
If what?
Polygamy.
Polygamy. Okay.
How do Benin?
I know.
Yeah.
Well, not only Benin, all Africans.
Yeah.
And even in Jamaica and Europe and America, yeah. They practice it more, but in a very clever and trickish way.
Yes. But that is not polygamy. That is girlfriend and boyfriend and sweetheart.
What is that? That is cheating.
That is sweetheart. We are talking about polygamy in terms of a man have more than one wife.
And that is what I'm telling you.
Yeah, but in Jamaica, a man do have more than one wife, you know. Him have him wife and him have a girlfriend. Him have a girl, him have a sweetheart. So that is not wife. That is concubine. So I talk about now.
Let me tell
the
you
legitimacy of polygamy in Benin.
You know, the white man or the white person, our people call him Ebo.
Yeah.
Then a reverend father is also Ebo. So they saw a white man, a reverend father coming. They say, look at Ebo. He said, no, it's not Ebo. It's a reverend father. What is the difference? You have a concubine or a girlfriend outside. I have two wives in the house. Tell me the difference.
The difference is that
you are a
I can tell you the difference.
The difference is that you are a thief and dishonest person.
No.
And then I'm a...
Yeah, and the difference is that the two people them in the house agree in the house with
yes.
In the sweetheart thing is a dodge.
Yes.
The sweetheart dodge and the wife feels her husband do have not more somebody but she. So, as well you said, deceit. So what may I say to you now? In the Benin... Do they have a polygamous relationship that is legitimate?
Yes, like in Jamaica and other places.
No, they don't have polygamy in Jamaica.
They have. In Benin? Huh?
No, wait.
Let me tell you, in Benin, I may have one wife in the house, in my house,
yeah.
And build house for the other one outside.
But the other one, no, it's, don't
we it? Still call them polygamists. But in America or Europe or in Jamaica, you say that's a mistress, that's a this, that's a this. But it's the
and
same.
And the other one know that you build the house for the other one.
The one in the house?
The one in the house know that you build the house for the next one.
Oh, yes.
That's what I said. But when we build house for the next one, the one in the house don't know.
That is why I call you a thief.
Yeah, they're not,
and a dishonest
that's
person.
That's why I'm asking you.
Uh-huh.
That's why I know. That's why I'm asking you. If in Benin,
we are number one in it. One of my kings married about 800 wives.
Yeah, well, I met a man who
had my gate man has 3 wives.
I met a man in Cameroon with 72
it's because
wives.
I'm educated and a refined native doctor that I don't want to practice it.
Don't want to practice what? Polygamy.
I will do it the way you do it here.
Sneak.
I will be hiding or stealing to go there.
Okay.
Yes. Okay. So I practice the Jamaica type.
No, not Jamaica type. I'm not Jamaican.
Call a spade a spade. Once you have an extra woman outside, you are a polygamist.
Right.
That is the definition. Definition. No, okay.
Brethren.
Okay.
I understand what you're saying. You know?
Okay.
It's you not understanding what I am saying.
Yes.
I just want to know. You see, when I go to Israel, when I go to certain part, the Muslims, in the Muslim tradition, the wives gather together, eat together, look after the children together in Muslim tradition.
We do it in Benin.
That's what I'm asking.
I said yes.
Because in Jamaica, we don't do it that way.
That is
in Jamaica, we hide. We hide and do it.
Okay.
So when I build a house to my other wife, I don't make that wife know that my wife, I build a house to that wife and I buy a car for that wife out there. And my wife in my house will feel like she's the only wife. No, I know what you say now that in Benin.
But she knows.
Instinctively.
The woman in the house knows it's only fooling the husband.
Yeah,
he said, leave this idiot to be playing himself about.
So they
all come to me everywhere in the world.
So you practice polygamy like
yes,
all the Muslims.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Like yes, sir. Yes, sir.
The Muslims.
Yes, sir.
Because I know the Muslims, how the Muslims work it.
Anyway, only the Benins and the Muslims. The Americans, the British, the Jamaicans, they don't. And if I were keeping record, you will find that the polygamists in Jamaica are more than the ones in there. So I'm telling your wives now to be very, very vigilant.
Well, man is by nature polygamous.
They should be very vigilant and tell you, go and bring her home or you leave her.
No,
I think the laws of this country should be revisited. So that,
well, I think so too.
Yeah, they forbid you going out to have a secret wife. Okay. If you are married, just marry her and bring her home.
That is what
then will make about. It will make you the right son of your ancestors.
All right, so you answer the question then.
Okay, yes, we are.
All right.
We are polygamists.
All right, what about female circumcision? Female circumcision. Yeah.
The most foolish thing that the House of Assembly in my state, in my country has done was to be making a law against female circumcision. It's stupidity. Nobody obeyed it. Let me tell you the values of circumcision.
Female circumcision.
Yeah, female circumcision. Yeah. You see, in the West, and maybe, do they do in Jamaica?
No.
And then their women will be like that. A lot of them, not all of them, are so promiscuous because their clitoris overgrow. And they are naturally sexually sensitive. When they are at alert, they make the body to be shaking and the woman can commit adultery anywhere or prostitute anywhere. Mm. It accounts for... I'm sorry, ladies. I don't mean to be rude.
No, we're just being a male chauvinist African. That's how
once
it is.
Yeah. That clitoris is not cut. There are some tribes in my country. They don't circumcise their girls until they are ready to have their first issue.
Yeah.
But in our own case, on the seventh day we circumcise them, except if the child is sick.
Yeah.
And then they wait until the baby is well.
Yeah.
They could delay it to 1 year, 2 years, 10 years, or so.
So what do they do with the child, the male child?
It's automatic. He must circumcise.
No, I mean, to prevent that promiscuity that you speak about. You said a while ago is because of promiscuity.
Yes, that they circumcise.
There are more promiscuous males than females.
In the West, you mean?
In Africa.
The males in Africa are circumcised?
No, not circumcision, no.
Okay.
Because we know circumcision is practice. Yeah. I'm talking about for not wanting promiscuity to be in the male population. What do they do with the male population in order to prevent promiscuous behavior by the male?
That is why they are also circumcised.
Circumcision don't stop you from being promiscuous.
That one?
No. Male circumcision does not stop promiscuous behavior.
It does, and two,
if
a male is not circumcised,
yeah,
like you see in some parts of the world,
yeah,
it looks ugly in that part of the region. You know,
what you call ugly? No, explain what you call Muta, ugly.
It's ugly because the cloth covering it.
Yeah.
Is there arbitrarily and it has no beauty decency. That's number
beauty,
one.
But nobody now hold it up in front and say, oh, this beauty.
It's not like that. As it continues to grow, yeah, as the body continues to grow,
yeah,
the teeth continues to grow and then is dropping too. Maybe you are. It's only your own. You know. You don't know others' own.
No. What I am asking. I got to talk about if it's a beauty in the penis and everything. What I'm saying to you is this. That circumcision of the male does not prevent promiscuity.
Firstly, it prevents. But one thing you must also know is that one thing you must also know that you see every pocket of mankind have been given laws by nature to follow.
Yeah,
and one of you, I was reading. A book today, advert.
So nature don't
Jamaica.
Know what they're doing when they make you with penis.
You circumcise them, you make them not to be promiscuous too, because...
That is not true. That is not true.
Okay.
Because African man...
Sexuality is promiscuity.
No, we're talking about the reasons for the female circumcision, according to you.
The first one is in obedience to natural law. Man and woman should be circumcised.
Why?
Because in Africa, there are some
that means
that forbid those people from entering their shrines and courts.
Yeah, that is in most tradition, in the Igbo tradition, it is then, like that too. But I am saying to you, my brethren, we're talking about the reason for female circumcision. And you gave the reason as
the most important thing for female thing. Belief is one thing, that is religion.
Yeah.
There are some tribes, when they do not circumcise their children and the clitoris is overgrown, they use rope to tie it like this. If it touches the baby's head, the baby will not live.
But you know, it's man doing these things to women.
Man doing it to women.
It's man creating these things. The promiscuity of women.
Yeah.
And the need to prevent this from all of the female quality. And now he's saying that he's going to invent something to prevent promiscuity amongst women, but him don't have nothing. And well, you can't have him balls. Maybe you should have cut off him balls then. Cut off his penis. Because I trust my brethren, circumcision no prevent promiscuity.
Mm.
Trust me, Panda one day.
So a woman that wants to flirt without with a circumcision is what you are saying?
No. What I am saying is that it's man that is deciding these things.
That they should be.
It's a promiscuity to you. And I am saying now, if that is the case for male, for female promiscuity,
it's not the only
that is an evil thing against women. To me, that's an evil action against women.
There are three major reasons.
Yes.
One is that naturally, there are some children, if their heads touch clitoris, they will not live.
Yeah.
Then two, the woman's body that is not, the woman that is not circumcised, the body will grow to such a place, it brings an ugliness to her.
I don't want to use obscene words. No, don't use obscene words. Just say vagina.
You can't say vagina. The clitoris.
Yeah.
Have you ever seen a clitoris that is as long as 4 inches?
Four inches.
Yes.
I never measure it yet, but I am.
Would that be a thing of beauty to that lady?
But it's not every woman that don't circumcise have that.
Well. Whatever
in
the
your case, tribe,
yes,
in Benin,
not only Benin, anyway,
yeah, in certain parts of Africa,
yeah,
women clitoris might grow to 4 inches where you have to cut it. But I am saying to you that this is a tradition that is saying promiscuity.
Yeah, sorry, dear, let me ask you a question. When did the Jamaicans start to circumcise their girls?
I don't know if women, a man circumcising girls in Jamaica,
yeah, because. You see, we are drawing the hands of the clock back. You inherited that from
when you left. You inherit. We inherit a male chauvinistic idea against women that say, in order for the woman don't go out there and have an ex man, you're going to cut her. To prevent that. Yet still, me know without a doubt that the male is more promiscuous. Where a woman will stay with her husband loyally, the chances of a man staying with his wife loyally is less.
Muta, let me tell you one thing. You are propagating axioms from maybe some books you have read.
Let me tell you authoritatively,
a woman that is not circumcised, a circumcised woman, if the husband is in prison for 10 years, he may be able to wait for many years.
Yeah.
An uncircumcised woman cannot.
So what happened to the man?
You have a program on the radio.
What happened to the circumcised man?
Start a research on a circumcised girl and an
uncircumcised. I don't have no circumcision taking place in Jamaica, but not the circumcised man.
Not those hungry otters.
Look at man, the circumcised man.
Yeah.
When him can't get a woman, him go for your next man. In a Jamaica prison.
Well,
in a Jamaica prison.
Look,
the circumcised man, when him can't get a woman,
that is
him
not.
Go for your next man.
What of women? Going with women.
No, we're not. No, here we know. We're not talking about women going with women.
No, what I'm trying to say is.
What I am trying to say is that circumcision of the male
does
not say that he will be less promiscuous.
Well,
that is what I am saying.
Well, naturally.
And to cut off a woman,
yeah,
clitoris, to say that it's going to look ugly. I mean, so you're telling me, say, nature don't know where to that door. Nature don't know where to that door. When
you see, the louse. You know louse?
Maybe in a Benin, the woman, them have some 5-inch clitoris. Are you
not
like?
No, not there, because we circumcise all our guests.
Look there. You see, all of them is circumcised.
We circumcise all of them. Let me tell you one thing. The louse says you resemble the land in where you stay. That is what I think is happening to circumcision or no circumcision in Europe, America, Jamaica, this and that. In Africa, it is a natural law that we should circumcise our children.
No, it's not a natural law. It's a law that was made by men.
Okay.
It's men make that law.
That's okay. I won't disagree with you that it's men that made it.
Yeah, man, and the men that made the law.
Like some holy books on earth were written by men that were in one situation or the other. Maybe those African laws were also made to correct or put in line certain things we think will conform.
Like what? Like what? Because human beings, we are working.
We are African traditional worshippers. We have a religion of ours.
I don't in this time or the time before. Because if it was benefiting Africans in that time, wouldn't be in the position where we're in right now.
You see,
you
have vindicated me. If we will be dragging the hands of the clock back when I said, if we did not obey natural accord for some of our people to leave home. If you were in Africa, you will advocate that we should. You won't say it is men that made that law that women should be.
The men of Africa go say it, man. Huh? I have been to many parts of Africa and said the same thing.
I know what I'm saying is, if you were born in Africa,
no, I would say it. Yeah, because I would be. If I was born in China, I would have said something else. I wouldn't be a Rasta. If I'm born in India, I wouldn't be. It's just so it goes. So I'm saying to you, when I look at it on the wider level and the reason, it's intelligence we are working with, you know.
Yes.
It's the reason. It's not cultural expression we are dealing with, you know.
Yes.
The reason why you do this, is it because of that? And when you do it because of that, does it prevent that from happening or lessen that from happening? I am saying to you, non-apologetically, that the circumcision of men does not stop you from being promiscuous. This circumcision of men, or what people say, when you go circumcised, you're susceptible to disease more than a man who's not circumcised. That is not true neither. And the circumcision of women, for the reason given that you just said,
I will prove
is
to
male
you as
chauvinistic at its highest level.
Yeah, as a traditional gynecologist of world repute that have worked with many medical schools on earth.
Yes.
Harvard is a university to be reckoned with.
Yes.
I have talked to them authoritatively,
and they are the ones who are destroying the world.
Not on this one, anyway. Obama. But what I'm telling Muta this evening is that women that are not circumcised are more promiscuous than men that are not circumcised. Let me put that way. And then, two, men that are circumcised or not circumcised are not as promiscuous as women that are not circumcised. And the beauty of those Garden of Edens are lost if they are not circumcised.
Which Garden of Eden you have?
Let us not go into religion. No, well, that part
what
of
you mentioned, but are you mentioned?
Let us that part of the
Benin, you come from a talk about Garden of Eden. Right?
Garden of Eden.
Which part of Garden of
Eden? Okay, where is Garden of Eden?
Oh, illusion that a white people illusion.
In Louisiana?
Illusion.
Oh, that is what I'm saying. White because there was not. What happened was, anyway, I don't want to go into religion.
Yeah,
your part of the body is where the Garden of Eden is. Yeah. That was the apple they ate.
Yeah.
So what I'm saying is, if the people in the Garden of Eden,
yeah,
which is not there, it's the human body, the man and the woman,
yeah,
were asked not to do certain things until they were this or that, and they did it, then their eyes were clear. If you know, the day a man starts with a woman, is the same cloud that falls from his eyes. Then he will be driven out of the garden.
All right, may I ask you a question?
Yes.
You're familiar with the term polyandry?
Mm-hmm.
You're familiar with that term polyandry?
Yes.
What do you think about polyandry?
What is the type?
What do you think about polyandry?
Well, it's indiscipline.
No, polyandry means a woman who have more than one husband.
That is what I'm saying. I say it's indiscipline.
Yes. For a woman to have more than one husband.
That is, I won't call it promiscuity now. It's a type of madness.
Yeah, but polygamy is not a type of madness.
No, because nature, God made it that men should marry more than one woman.
Who, God make that?
Or is God made the law.
Man make that, man.
Why, No. Why we say God made it is that
a man make that.
Yes, whether man made it or God made it.
Nothing to do with that.
Why we always say that nature made it is you see, the body reacts to nature's laws.
Yeah, man is by nature polygamous.
Yes.
It has nothing to do with God. Man is by nature polygamous.
What is by nature? Nature means if you are by nature, it means nature has commanded you.
As some man steer. That may I say.
Nature has commanded you to do certain. That is why you are by nature this.
Yes.
But woman by nature is not made to
it's not polygamous.
A polygamist.
Yeah.
The woman.
So when
not
a woman...
Not polygamist in the sense of, we are saying it in polyandry.
Yeah, all right. So in polyandry...
Yes.
When a woman take more than one husband in a culture...
Yes.
That does not see this as wrong...
Yes.
You are saying that it is a type of
indiscipline. Yes.
In that culture, it don't come that way.
You know why? If nature is anything to go by,
yes,
because many of us or many people do not believe in the existence of God.
Yes.
So they believe that anything that happens has a reason for happening, but not prompted by any power or any medium.
The power man. Power of man there.
Yes. Then what I'm saying is when a woman marries more than one husband.
Yes.
And put them in the same house.
Yes.
I think I know a couple, a lady that has two husbands.
Yes.
In a country.
Yes.
Which I don't want to mention.
I asked them,
it's not Jamaica. I asked where it is so, the man said it is so in their culture.
Yes.
Then I said, where are you from? He mentioned it then, because I hate discussing religion and condemning people's culture.
Yes.
You see, the pocket of mankind you come from dictates the thinking of your mind.
People, true. That's what you call anthropology.
Yes.
Meaning so you react to the environment where you come from.
Your meat could be another man's poison.
Yeah, yeah.
But what is there is an attempted decency to be approached by man.
Yes.
If you look at it...
A universal truth you're talking about.
You what?
You're talking about a universal truth.
Exactly.
Yes.
So there are certain things you should not allow to do. I have so many lesbians as clients and patients.
Yes.
One of them just phoned me yesterday that he has got a new wife, a lady.
A lesbian. Yes.
He said, I've got a new wife from San Domingo or something like that. Because the former one in Argentina was misbehaving. I can't tell her you are wrong because they are in the land of the free. Mm. So what I'm saying is there are many things that we ought not to take as right.
No, me understand. Nature. No, I am agreeing with you, you know.
Yes.
I just asking you how you see it. And I'm agreeing with you. I am knowing, say, you know, I mean, but what I am saying is that most of these laws was created by men to keep that feminine energy in place so that man can manipulate it. You see? Because these ideas That is prophet.
African women, you are saying? You can't manipulate a Jamaican woman or an American woman.
No. Listen to me.
Yes.
No, we are saying there's laws that man set in the earth.
Okay.
That is used against women.
Hmm.
Most of the laws, like religion, to me, religion was created by insecure men. Insecure men create religion and say that it's God putting these things inside of them. And then they push it out there like it's a divine energy that is pushing it. And a lot of it is to oppress women.
You see, in one of my records, I will send one to you.
One of these?
Oh. Not this one. I said...
I don't like how not where you give me the part of the party, so the way I said that party.
I said, because of my neighbors, I'm afraid to say that I do not believe in God, because they will say, oh, our neighbor is already in. The reason why I said it is that there are so many things happening around us that ought not to happen.
Yes, definitely.
So the reason why I'm saying it, when you are talking of nature, talking of this, talking of that, I agree to very limited extent, because even the religion you are saying, I agree with you in total. Religion was only created by man to mellow down our wicked energies. If you kill a person, you have offended certain people.
If you kill,
but they kill anyhow
any
today.
Killing is an offense to everybody.
They kill anyhow today, but we are not offending anybody. What I'm trying to say is that if you follow the commandments of the Bible, you follow the commandments of the Benin, you will be asking whether the Bible stole from Benin. Plagiarated Benin.
Because you believe that Benin is the center of the world. That is why you would say that they steal from them.
You say what?
You believe that Benin is the center of everything.
On earth?
Yes, on earth.
I would be a fool to think that. But what I'm saying is...
You're not a fool, tell me what you believe about Benin. Because I am looking through this and I'm listening to you and... You are Benin.
Yes, I'm a Benin.
Yeah.
But what I'm trying to say is, for instance, before any law, we didn't know of the Western commandments until about 200 or so years ago.
Yeah.
Before then, we had already known that you should respect your father and your mother.
Ah, see?
You should not kill.
Who wasn't in darkness?
You should not kill.
Yeah.
No, when I say darkness, you are holding me to it.
No. I show me a true steward. We don't live in a glass house. We can't show a steward. Go and talk. Talk, man. You see, we had him turn friend, you know. We had him a big friend, you know. Trust me. Yeah, continue, man. Continue.
So what I'm trying to say really is if you convert any human being or an African into any religion he doesn't belong to originally, when he's passing through life's vicissitudes, he returns to that which he knows.
Yeah, so what is our original religion?
Our original religion is the belief on the things around us and talk to them to anything we don't understand in nature.
White people call it animism.
Well, that is to them.
Yeah, that's it. White people call it animism.
Yes, because they didn't know what to use to condemn a religion that is superior to their own.
Yes, yes.
So if you go into the lexicon definition of paganism,
yes,
you will find that pagans are in Europe
pagans
and other places, not in Africa.
Yeah.
Because then... when they came, they said our religion is paganism, which is not. We don't have paganism in Africa.
Yeah, but paganism is a word, you know. But if you look on the ideas of paganism,
yes,
you will find it in Africa.
It's also in Europe and Jamaica.
No, I am saying.
Okay, what is paganism?
Paganism is a kind of nature worship religion.
Well,
we see
if it's nature worship, we shouldn't have been quarreling with the white man.
No, paganism. But it's not every white man was pagan. Listen to me now. Wait, stick up there.
We can call it paganism, you know, but the definition of paganism and what pagans used to do is not unique. For instance, locks in Jamaica.
Yeah.
A whole lot of people say locks and them say Rasta.
Yes.
But locks is not unique to Rasta.
Yeah.
There are many people, including Nigeria, as we just spoke of earlier.
Paganism, Pagamos, came from the West when some rude and rascally and robbers in Europe and other parts of the world, apart from Africa, were collected and taken to a place and they were called pagans.
But what did the pagans believe?
It's in the books they wrote themselves.
Right, what did the pagans believe?
Pagans believe in nothing other than, what would I call it? They were not religious anyway.
No, what did they believe?
They were hooligans, robbers, and things like that.
No, but that is not true. That is not true, my dear. No.
Okay, check.
I'm talking about, because you have Christians who are robbers and Christians who are thieves. I am saying that there is a belief system in Christianity.
Yes.
That is not robbery and that is not thieving.
Yes.
I am saying to you, so you're not that you're calling yourself pagan, because I don't call myself Christian because I believe a certain way, and you can find it in the Bible. Not because you can find some of the things that I believe in makes me a Christian.
Yeah, in that book I said there is no religion on earth that does not practice sacrifice.
Yeah.
Every religion. You have blood sacrifice, you have smoke sacrifice, you have
human sacrifice.
Sacrifice is sacrifice.
The Israelites used to sacrifice human beings.
Even the Chinese,
yes,
they will tie them and place them over a bamboo stick shoot.
Yeah, the Incas, the Mayans, all of them.
Then in Britain, they will put human blood in a balloon and fly with it.
So what do Benin people sacrifice?
All those are sacrifices.
What do Benin people sacrifice?
Before. Maybe we stopped human sacrifice more than 100 years ago.
So 100 years ago, you were still sacrificing people?
Oh, yes, of course.
Okay. So why you stop?
The reason why we stop is we started developing, we developed our culture within the circumstances involved with our religious belief.
Okay, so evolving.
Because in the olden days, they were not purely for religion.
Okay.
The sacrifices were not purely for religion.
What was it
for? One, it was a punishment.
Okay. You mean like a criminal, you sacrifice a criminal?
Exactly.
Yeah.
Either you commit murder, you do this, then they sacrifice him.
Okay.
Instead of going to hang him or not, he say sacrifice him to the gods.
Have you ever been, was it a part of the Benin sacrifice or sacrifice virgins?
Foster.
Virgins.
Where they sacrifice virgins?
Was Benin, in Benin, did they, like in certain traditions, like in the Hebrew tradition, in the Mayans,
virgin, in Benin in the olden days, within the palace system, virgins were sacrificed or used, for certain charms.
All right, so why did they stop?
I said the religion has
evolved
since they were not purely for religion.
No, the virgins part matter. It's not purely for
religion. No, it's human sacrifice, whether virgin or...
But we're talking about the virgins.
Yeah.
The female virgins.
Yes.
Yeah. I am asking you...
Why it stopped?
Why did they stop sacrificing
females? It was not for religious purpose.
Oh, the sacrificing at the virgin wasn't religious purpose.
Even the men, they were only sacrificed for offenses.
Criminals, yeah.
But the virgins were purely for herbal or charm or voodoo making.
Yes. So you kill the
you sacrifice the criminals.
Let me ask.
So, well, I see in Christianity, Jesus gets sacrificed as a criminal.
Every one of them, yeah. In Old Testament.
God gave him only son as a sacrifice.
That's
what I talk about now is this tradition of the sacrifice.
Abraham and his Isaac.
Yeah, him did sacrifice sacrificed. Him son.
And many that we are not reading.
Yeah.
You've definitely, with your exposure and wide reading, you have read the lost books of the Bible.
Yes. Uh-huh. Yes.
So, and
but we don't want to go for the last books of the Bible. We want to ask you something about Benin. Yeah. The Benin thing a while ago.
You know there are two Benins.
Yeah,
the Benin country was founded by my Benin. You know that too?
Yes.
The soldiers from my town.
Bendel State, Benin in Bendel State.
Yes, founded the Benin country in West Africa.
Yeah, but we could go back to this religious idea of sacrifice. Because we go to Belize and we see them sacrifice. Mm. Them two women after the pyramids them.
As I'm looking it, only Jamaica may not have made human sacrifice.
No, we sacrifice humans every day, Anya. So we have the most sacrifice, Anya.
So. Oh, I
yeah, we
know.
Use gun.
So why is Benin's own so we use gun in your mouth?
No, because no. I am trying to. Okay. No. We're there.
Okay.
Look here. I'm just trying to get a historical perspective.
Okay, that's good.
I want to know, you know. I don't want to believe. I want to know. I am saying that we kill people every day, Anya. So
do you know power?
Yes.
Is the source for human sacrifice.
Yes.
And that is number one.
Because power...
If you have authority over life,
you decide
you can use it anything you want to do.
That is what big men do. Like Bush and Bin Laden, and now we say Osama doing it. No, what we are saying, we could go back
Let
to
me
Benin.
Make a parable to you.
Benin, we want to talk about
Let me know. Tell yes. you one thing.
The
when a child... If your child sees your wife in bed, that's his mother or her mother, with another man.
Yes.
If he doesn't tell you, the ancestors of your family will kill him or her.
Yeah.
If he tells you, the ancestors of the mother's family will kill him or her.
Yes.
So, I don't know. A king's servant that does not stammer, they will cut his head off.
Yes.
So,
yeah, we know that.
Talk to me, Benin. Religion, medicine, that one minus politics or anything.
No, just you see, when we talk about sacrifice, it's part of the religion because I thought.
Ogun is annoying. The god of iron is annoying. That is why he's pushing men and women to do what they are doing. So,
yes.
A time will come when we will realize that prayers alone will not help us.
Well, prayers obviously is not helping us.
Because you can't have a son on your foot and then raise it up and be saying, I command you in the name of Ogubu, be healed. It will not heal.
Definitely.
Unless you go and pluck leaves from the roadside in Jamaica and then squeeze and put on it.
Of course.
So,
faith without works, the Christian can.
Man is intoxicated and the whole world is in madness.
Yes.
So, we are watching if I do not believe in the end of life.
Yes.
Whether power will not
life
be.
Cannot end. Life cannot end.
Yeah.
But the program can.
Mm.
This program can end. And this is the end of the program. Now, when you say leave Jamaica, when you're leaving, when are you leaving Jamaica?
Oh, I'm leaving on Saturday morning. I will soon be back. So I will come to meet you so that you help me look for a concubine outside. I won't put her inside, so I will be coming always.
Yeah, and then you can give me a sneer that I can give a cock and make him crow. So hear what now? When you come back to Jamaica, you come to visit me.
Okay.
Come to visit me. You spend some time with me. And then we go through all of this again. And
okay.
Then you can show me some of the herbs and things.
I will show you.
Yes.
And I will want you to see is the oracle of faith and fortune, because I want to share it with the Jamaicans.
Yes.
The day is going to be done.
Yes.
I will come with my full regalia. My full regalia is a whole luggage.
Yeah, I know that.
So
I know that.
Then you will arrange your mics so that we set a table. Yes. I get into trance so that I don't fall any of them.
Yes.
Then people will be phoning in.
Yes.
Yeah. I will say, you that phone me.
We never take no phone call. It's a pretty, but I saw it go. We never take no phone call. But the conversation was lively.
Okay.
We give thanks for you to extend this invitation.
No problem.
To come here in this hours of the morning for me really vexes or annoy you this week. But this is the cutting edge. You're not going to go on no other program that behave like this.
Thank you.
Yes. And as we say, if you come again, the invitation is open to come for the program. Mm. And I would love to see you get in that trance. You know, if I did have a next half hour, I'd love to see the trance. I'll mash up make the place mash up. But I will definitely, I got 6 pages. Meanwhile, I was playing the tape. I reached about 6 pages out of this book.
Yeah.
So I will be reading these books. And then I will really see. I understand it. You know, yeah. It's just that I think, just like what you said, the evolution of sacrifice.
Mm.
I think Africans need to evolve out of certain things now. Because those things is what help us to be in the darkness that we find ourselves in the West here. Because trust me, black people a serious darkness in the Western world here. Serious. Yeah. Mm. So we say give thanks to the moment. Give thanks to the sister for coming with you. Give thanks to the brethren for drive you.
Yeah.
And it's just so. It's just so. So Matrix, at 2 o'clock, you know, so we're done exactly 2 o'clock here, sir. You can't tell somebody that.